Hello, Play the Game family. Welcome to the show. Thank you for joining us. This episode is brought to you by Lone Wolf Paintball. They are an online supplier and have been around since the beginning of the game as Michigan's premier paintball field and paintball supplier since 1987. They are rapidly expanding into the online retail space and supplying everything you need for paintball and to just have a great time out there at your local paintball fields. They're amazing for the paintball community, and they have got it all for you. Go to lonewolfpaintball.com to get any of your favorite brands, and head over there and take a quick surf on the Lone Wolf Paintball wave at lonewolfpaintball.com. They have what you need at a great price, and they boast amazing customer service and same-day shipping, which is outstanding because it's always nice to order something and know it's on its way immediately. So go ahead, give them a look, check out their YouTube, their Instagram. The Instagram name is Lone Wolf PB. YouTube is Lone Wolf Paintball. And keep up to date with deals, sales, and content. PTG is absolutely honored to have them on board. So head over to lonewolfpaintball.com and become a part of their community. Play the Game podcast is brought to you by Transfuse. Transfuse is the greatest electrolyte formula in the universe. It is amazing. You need to have this stuff in your kitchen. You need to have it in your car, in your bag. If you're traveling, just have it around because it is going to save you. It is going to be that boost that you need to keep you going strong into your day and into a tournament for paintball. We absolutely love it, and we've been using it religiously for over a year. Dynasty has been trying it out. We've been passing it out to all the guys, and the proof is in the pudding. It has been working. Practices are able to last longer because we can play longer. The tournaments have been obviously going well. We won World Cup, and we were using Transfuse out there. It is easy. It's portable. It's delicious. It's nutritious. It's everything that you need in your life, and you need to give it a try. Top pros are using it. They're at all the NXL events, and obviously, if these top-tier athletes are using it to be the best version of themselves, you should probably give it a look. It has magnesium, potassium, and sodium to keep you hydrated. It has zinc, vitamin C, vitamin B, and choline to give you a cognitive and immunity boost. And it is delicious. It is just good stuff. You're going to absolutely love this stuff. So I want you to try it. Tell us what you think. Give us a message. Tropical Bliss is my favorite, so maybe give that one a look. They're going to be doing a lot of big things in 2021, so stay tuned for Transfuse and some of the big developments that they have. Don't be dehydrated. Use Transfuse. Go to translabs.com, TRANZLABS.com. Use code PLAYTHEGAME, and you'll get 10% off. If you subscribe to a monthly service, you'll get an additional 11% off, so you could potentially take advantage of 21% off on Transfuse. Do not sleep on this stuff. Give it a look and enjoy. PTG is brought to you by Heal Brand CBD. They are a CBD powerhouse making a huge splash in the paintball industry in 2021 and beyond. Be on the lookout for them at NXL events and everywhere in between. CBD is an absolute staple in my healing process, and they are helping out so many people. They want to heal the world, and we want to help them along on their mission to do that. They create the highest quality CBD products you've ever seen, and I know because I've been using them for quite some time. They have amazing stuff like nanotechnology, which I only recently learned about, which is pretty spectacular. It is taking that large CBD particle, and what Heal Brand is doing is breaking that down into microscopic greatness with their process, which will allow for the particles of CBD to pass through your cell wall more quickly and more efficiently. As opposed to normal CBD, it could take some time before you start to feel the effects. With nanotechnology, you feel the effects immediately because that particle is getting through those cell walls with more efficiency and able to go to work quicker. People are using this stuff for inflammation, anxiety, and also as a sleep aid. Heal Brand has an amazing knockout shot that you have to check out. You got to head over to the website and check out all these amazing products for your pets, for yourself, for recovery, and just for feeling better in life. They have a wide variety of benefits that CBD can provide, and my favorite that they have is the cool down cream. They have a cool down cream that I use for soreness and recovery after getting shot up with paintballs and I'm all bruised. It's nice to rub that stuff on there. And then also if you strain a muscle, it really helps with loosening it up and making it feel great. So head over to healbrand.com, HEALBRAND.com. Use code PLAYTHEGAME and you will get 10% off of your orders. That is exclusively for the Play the Game family. We are so appreciative of everybody supporting us and supporting the sponsors. So head over and give Heal Brand a look.
What's going on, everybody? Thank you guys so much for tuning into the show. This episode, we have Esham Nelms. He is a very successful Hollywood director that has worked with some major stars, and he has been highly integrated in the game of paintball for a long time. His heritage runs really deep, so it was awesome hearing some of those stories. He actually used to play with some of the old Dynasty guys back on Lofty, so it was really cool hearing stories of him running around with Young Oliver, Alex, and all those guys. And the things he has done in Hollywood as a director and his vision for paintball and how we can film our sport and really just his grit for pursuing the career he did and still, you know, having this passion towards paintball was really interesting, really, really informative. So without further ado, we're going to hop in the show. See you soon.
That was an insane inside move by Marcelo Margot. Great communication.
And the crowd starts chanting Harmon. Great, great shot by all the guys. Tyler Harmon saved that game. He came out with two wins. Marcelo Margot was on fire.
What an honor, PTG fam. We have none other than Esham Nelms on the show, who is a superb director who has just dropped Fat Man. It's on Netflix. You can go check that out. He's also come out with films like Small Town Crime, which is also on Netflix, Waffle Street, Lost on Purpose, and shout out to 2005, Night of the Dog. Thank you so much, Esham, for coming on this show. We appreciate it.
Hell yeah.
Guys, it's an honor, honestly. I'm a big fan of the show. I listen to it religiously. So, you know, to be here in the hot seat is quite the honor. Thank you, guys.
Awesome,
dude,
man.
Thank you.
That's not the hot seat, man. We're all just here hanging out, having a good time, dude. Trust us. It's an honor. We know you have a ton of really good ideas for paintball. Being in the Hollywood scene and having the success you have outside of paintball, I'm super excited. I know Tyler is as well, to sit here and pick your brain. And hopefully we can spark some ideas to help move paintball forward in the right direction.
Yeah, dude, I mean, I think that's it, right? It's just an enthusiasm for the game. And like, let's figure out how to make this sucker pop and transcend where we're at.
Yeah, absolutely. That's it. Because we have something that's beautiful, everything. You know, this game is amazing. It's something that a lot of people have fallen in love with. And so it's not for a lack of a good product, that's for sure. Something just has not quite clicked yet. And it's a multitude of things, but certainly, you know, how we are presenting it to the masses has to be part of that. So, you know, of course, we can always do better and come up with ideas and continue to push in new directions.
But, you know, what's exciting for me is just to see how that conversation and perspective has evolved just in the, 86 episodes you guys have done now, right?
Yeah,
absolutely.
It's amazing to like, to hear even your arc in the perspective of paintball recently, right? Like all paintball is good paintball, you know?
Absolutely.
Just people playing, you know? I think a gentlemanly paintballer like myself, that over 40 crowd, you know, you gotta show that there's a place for them in the sport as well.
Totally.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Paintball for everybody, man. That's the mantra. I'm headed to a 10-man event in Maryland, the ICCPL or the ICPL. That's going to be a pretty fun one with Cowboy Roy Richards. We're going out there.
Is that this
amazing
weekend?
That's going to be fun.
Yeah.
So what's that? I played against you guys in 10 man, or at least you, Tyler. Marcel, I don't remember if you played, but it was the Surf City Open in LA.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you guys had like Brian Cole, the whole thing was out there playing. Yeah, it was great. Honestly, I got my old S5 CCM monococker out and went out and had some good times with you guys.
Oh, 10 man.
We did.
Is the best.
Yeah, we did lose. You guys did womp us, and we were so close to making that cut.
It was Brian Cole. It's because we had BC.
I was just gonna say that. I was gonna say you had BC on the other team. I mean, tough hill to climb there.
Yeah.
You know, if you shoot him, he's not
Glenn
coming
Forrester
out.
Doing the, yeah, you had Glenn Forrester doing the scouting too. Yes.
That's great.
He's still running rackets out there. He was out here in Arizona just recently. We played a 7-man event, and Glenn's out there, you know, crunching numbers and doing the whole deal, having some fun.
It's amazing. I got to pick his brain about how to do the whole like player coach thing, right? That's a tough needle to thread. Mm-hmm. And I kind of find myself, we'll get into that story, but I kind of find myself in a coach capacity right now, which is interesting for my team.
Mm-hmm. And so what team is it that you're rocking with these days?
I'm currently playing on Extreme, but it's been a long journey to get there. But yeah, I'm currently playing on Extreme out of not Extreme New York Extreme.
Yeah.
Like Extreme LA Extreme. They play out of Glenn's place, Ambush.
Awesome.
Okay, cool. Yeah, I saw actually those videos you sent me of the WCPPL. I didn't realize you were at that event. I was out there too.
Yeah, dude. Oh yeah, you were at the one at Glenn's?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, amazing. Yeah. That was not a good event for us. We ended up getting savage. The last one in Arizona was a dramatic U-turn. So we went from 18th place to third.
Nice. There you go. Podium. Dude, that's a big step up right there.
Trending in the right direction.
What do you guys think you did differently from that event until this event in Arizona?
Well, a few things, right? So one is that, like, let's just kind of get into it, right? That perspective camera that I showed you, which is like, it's a higher perspective. It shows the whole field. And so I took on the capacity of coaching the team after I damaged my shoulder last year and had to have surgery. So I was out for 6 months, no play. Okay. And rather than, you know, crying my Cheerios and sulk around a little bit, I tried to find something, you know, constructive to put my energy forward. So I kind of wanted to become a student of the game. And so through that, I was like, oh, well, let me flex some of my video stuff. So I got some GoPros, I got some drones. I was just filming the game to sort of do some, like, I don't know, just some videos, right, to promote the sport. I just remember flying the drone one day and during practice, and I got it up there pretty high, like what you would say the equivalent of like the NFL L22 camera, right? Okay. Where you could see the whole field, every which way of it, and then you could see every player moving on the field. And this, like, I just left it there and I was just watching the team play. And it's only through the iPhone screen. But instantly I was like, wow, this is so superior to what I can see behind the net or even from the sideline, right? Because you can see everyone's gun or whatever it is. So I just recorded the whole scrimmage in that perspective. I just put the drone up. I recorded like a bunch of our points. And then I went home and I sat in front of the computer and I was editing these all together because our team does like a weekly Zoom. So I put all this footage together, I throw it up online, and then we review the game tape and we start watching over and we sort of like constructively give each other feedback. And my girlfriend walks in behind me and she's like, oh, hey, what are you doing? Oh, I'm putting together these videos. And she's like sitting there, she goes, and I'm like, see, you can see here, like where he's supposed to be watching the snake, but he takes his gun off. And of course the guy exploits the gap, dives right into snake one, crawls the snake, you know, the snake 50 and starts shooting our guys in the back. She's like, oh, wow, that's crazy. And I'm like, yeah. And then this next game, I cue to the next game. I'm like, you know, we're teed up. We're supposed to be watching these gaps. But boom, they go through and we're not doing it again, right? So she turns to me and she goes, you know, Ash, like we've been together 7 years. And I've watched Go Sports with you countless times. I've been to tournaments. I've seen you play the game. And she's like, in 2 minutes and with this perspective, I understand paintball for the first time.
Wow.
Just from that elevated perspective where you could see the whole field and you could actually see where all the guns were pointing, right?
Absolutely. Asham, dude, I think you broke it wide open here. Do you know how in video games you have like a little map in the corner, right? It's just this little kind of map. I think you could do that and do a like a screen in screen of the up vision shot, which shows you in the bottom corner where all the guns are pointed and where the people are moving. You have this little picture in the bottom corner showing that movement. And then on the main screen, you can have the big cameras swinging around, but that way you can see what's actually going on with the game. Cause that's what we're playing, is a game and not just these cut little snippets of what the game is doing and not getting the full picture. I think it's amazing, man. That's crazy.
And then like, well, let's take it a step further. Cause I think you're absolutely right. Right. But like, even thinking about, let's just go back to that last event, right? And there's like a couple like great battles in the middle, right? Like, oh, there's a battle in the middle here happening between whoever, Sewers and whoever, right? And they're in the middle of their gun battling. And then you like, but you're like, okay, well, that gun battle is amazing, but what else is happening on the rest of the field? But if you have that grand perspective, you can cut out, right, from the close-up to the wide and not lose the gun battle in the middle, you still can see the gun battle in the middle. You're just out wider. Now you can see all the peripheral players and how they're engaging in the game. So I think it's interesting, man. Like, I think Go Sports is doing a tremendous amount right. Right? Like, that broadcast Absolutely. Is evolving and going and trending in the right direction. It's amazing. I love watching it. But it's all right, let's push it to the next level here. And I would say even beyond that, let's enhance the paintballs, right? Mm-hmm. Because you can't see the paint. You can't see you guys do these utterly athletic moves where you're diving through streams or how you're being held back by a stream or whatever, right? Mm-hmm. So I think we could take a color if everyone agreed. And I would love to do a proof of concept with this. And I'm actually working on lining that up right now. But if we took a color, protected it like they do, right? Pink. But you might have to take two colors. We might have to take pink and yellow.
Yellow
because
is
one would be the fill. Yes. Yeah. But in WC it's pink. So we might need two because we might need two because one could be the fill color and one can be the shell. And you would in order to do this visually with VFX, you would need to key the shell. Right. And then you add just a little bit of a pop on the shell. So it not garish, but how they did sort of the hockey puck for Fox way back in the day. Just a little glow, a little augmentation. So you can see the paint and the streams flying out of the barrels. I think it would just help the layperson understand.
Esham, they removed that glow from the hockey puck, didn't they? Is that accurate? I thought
they did.
They did. Do you have any idea why?
I think some people, the purists, thought it didn't, was in poor taste.
I see. Mm. I see. Mm. I get it. I know when I watch hockey, I'm like, dude, I can't see what's going. You know, it's so hard to follow the puck. It really is. But real quick, what my argument always to it is, they make up for it with their slow motion replays, so that you can then get a visual of what just happened. And I think in paintball, we talk about this on the show all the time. If they were able to do away with split deck, and you had 2 minutes to then go back in slow motion and show one of the shots, a gunfight where somebody is snap shooting out of a bunker. You see the barrel leave the ball, leave their barrel, go all the way downfield, connect on somebody and explode. Paintball in slow motion is one of the most visually stimulating things that I've ever seen. And I like to think that I look at it without biased eyes, comparing it to other sports and things like that. It just looks cool. You know what I mean? And I feel like if we could do more of that, it would kind of fall in line with that a little bit, it would definitely show it better at least.
Absolutely. And I think Marcelo, it's okay to be biased. Everybody in this room right now is biased, man. We all love paintball. People listening to this podcast love freaking paintball. So there's nothing wrong with that. I think you're absolutely right, man. And I think I would almost delineate the two, right? So I would say Go Sports, do the live broadcast, maybe add the wider perspective, right? We don't want to take away from any of that. Do your split deck. I get it. You guys got to get these things done in a timely manner. Mm-hmm. But maybe go back, re-edit them as an encore presentation and put the semis and finals up, right? So you have three matches that are totally where you can go down, you can break down and elaborate on what moves are being made, what strategies being implemented, and we can see more game insight and maybe even get the damn teleprompter where you can draw on it and all that good stuff.
I think that's the easiest fix in the short term, and it's so doable. That is a very doable thing because they already take the games, they cut them up, they post the semifinals and the finals afterwards with some cool extra FX. I guess I don't know what it takes to do some of the stuff you're referring to, but that could make all the difference, and that could capture eyes of people that aren't familiar with paintball as it currently stands. They don't need a live event. But a cool post-production match might be good enough, or even just cool post-production videos that capture people's attention on the internet, which is so easy to do nowadays,
Absolutely. And I think, look, they kind of do it with the tactics episodes, right?
Yeah. Yep.
A little bit, but it needs that, just that slight enhancement. And I think if you made it a super polished, slick broadcast with a little bit of CGI enhancement, a little bit more advanced game analytics, mm-hmm. I feel like that pill is a lot easier to digest for the layperson, and you get to double dip on your material. Why not do that? Totally. You've already captured the material.
Yeah, absolutely. No, it makes sense, right? How hard would it be for us to put that little picture in picture, having a drone up and then throwing that into a feed? Because it all has to be, fed to the system and then uploaded and everything.
Yeah, honestly, I don't think it's that hard, right? And so I would, number one, I would not do it with a drone. I do it with a drone currently because that's the most economically feasible opportunity for me. I would run a pole up on a, you know, from a van or something like that, right? Like a broadcast van, like a television van or something. Just get the pole, put your red 6K camera up there, bang it down towards the field, get that master perspective. And then like, and here's something even more, guys, like what if that feed was piped into your pit? So much like, let's think about football, right? So you have your offensive, defensive coordinators up in the booth watching tape and they're making adjustments based on what the team is doing. Why it's not like have that? But why not have that in your own pit, right? So it's like, hey, you know, whoever, you know, SK is getting the intel from his offensive and defensive coordinators who are on the screens, and he's out there making adjustments with you guys.
Yeah, it is really difficult for the coaches to even see anything from, like, a lot of the times from where they're at. They're like, they have no clue what's really going on out there unless us as players come back and bring them information. They're like blind. Our coaches essentially play paintball blind.
It's absurd, right? How are you supposed to make adjustments on a game you can't even see? You can see through two layers of net, you know, and then you have everybody's like biased perspective coming in, you know? And so like, you know, it's like, hey, what happened out there? Oh man, I was running out, I got hit and I split in. It's like, no, well, actually in reality, you ran out, popped out the side and caught the first ball on your goggles. So it's like, another thing that was amazing is like when we started looking at that game tape, man, from the scrims, the tape doesn't lie. So you can't BS your way through like why you were getting shot. You know, it's like, man, that lane, every time I try to pass through, it's like, well, no, you're shooting right-handed out of the left side of your bunker and you're standing over the top of the tall cake. That's why you're getting gogged, you know? So it's like those are the sort of things. And the player literally may not even have it, right? In the heat of the moment, like whatever happens, you know, it happens. So It really did, man. That higher perspective, I feel, is the key to the future.
And the more that I think about it, I've never really thought about it in the ways that I've just thought about it, but you're absolutely right, because I know what some of the most exciting gameplay that I get out of playing video games is reading the map, reading that little thing in the corner. And then for a viewer, it kind of turns it into, we got to do what works. Video games are working. It's a freaking monster of an industry. And paintball is not too far of a stretch from what's already working. So if we can kind of align ourselves with what's already working, make it super digestible, super fun, and to where video gamers want to play paintball, that's a huge market space transition and will bring unfathomable amounts of money into paintball if we can find a way to network that, you know?
Absolutely. I mean, look, I came from skateboarding. That was like my first true love was skateboarding. And
shout out,
and
me just, too.
Right? Like, although those tray flips don't come as easy, not without some sprained ankles. Yeah. No. But like the way that that sport is marketed, right? Mm-hmm. And I will say this, man, like skateboarding for all intents and purposes appears, I'm not saying they are, but appears to not give a damn if anybody consumes it or watches it or not. And that makes it sexy. It's like, we're here, we're doing our thing. Like, when you got into skateboarding, was it because you wanted to make $1 million?
No.
It's not, right? It's like you see that sort of iconic Vans, you know, at the, you know, whatever era you're in, and whether you're tight jeans, loose jeans. Yes, it's the culture, man. You buy into the culture. And I would challenge you right now to say, what is paintball's culture? Like, can you look at a paintball player and say, that's a paintball player? I can look at a skater and say that.
I think you can, actually. I think we joke about this often. No, like when you're at the through the airport, I'm like, oh, that's a paintball player. I think it's akin to a skateboarder almost, you know?
Yeah.
It's kind of a little bit of a misfit, you know?
It is, man. It's paintball culture. That's what attracts me to it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, me too, man. I'll never forget the young years of like admiring the skaters. I was like, man, I want to do tricks like that guy. I want to, you know, or you know, be able to pull these stunts. And if we can build that culture up, that's tremendous. That's why we built this platform as well, is to like to nurture that culture and to nurture the culture of paintball and push it as far as we possibly can.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, and looking like when I started playing, there were really like players, and I think they're super iconic players right now, right? You guys are two of them, but like, you know, Fedorov and his pink gun, like everybody has like that little bit of, you know, Yaya and his leopard. But it's like, there was Opalak when I came up, right? There was Dave Youngblood. You know, like these dudes went out and repped some flannel in the woods, gave in this tux, you know, like with this chrome autococker. And I just remember seeing these dudes on the front of like Action Pursuit magazine and just being enamored, right? Like, oh man, look at that. Look at that hardware. Look at that dude. Look at him making it, and like making his own impression on the sport. Mm-hmm. And like, it's interesting, man. Like I would even challenge the deepest conventions of our sport, right? So like, what if, and sorry if I'm just disgorging all this, like this is stuff with you guys, because for me, this is just like an idea mill, right? Like we're just batting stuff back and forth in heaven. That's right. But it's like, so instead of you guys each getting, and look, you guys are, you know, HK hooks you guys up, but right? But it's like, instead of you guys each getting a different jersey for each event, right? Mm-hmm. What if each player gets a signature series jersey for the season? Mm. So you design it. The only parameters are you set them up, right? It's got to be this color and have a dragon on it or whatever and say Dynasty, whatever, across the chest and have your name on the back. But it can be anything from like, you know, a Jackson Pollock painting to like some of the more contemporary styles that we have now.
Yeah. Pollock, man, that's my favorite. I was just going to say Jackson Pollock is the man, dude. If you don't know about Jackson Pollock, look him up.
That falls in line with somewhat of the like motocross theory, treating players more as individual athletes. We've had this conversation with Dave Chaney, who, you know, did marketing at Under Armour, now works at New Balance, worked at Red Bull. And his vision for paintball is for players to be able to go out and get their own personal endorsements and promote their likeness and their brand individually instead of at a team level, which you see like in paintball, you kind of do both. Players and teams kind of do both. And actually, fun fact, our Dynasty jerseys from the last event are kind of like what you're talking about. Each one of our jerseys has like special, unique things to the player. It's not as noticeable as I think you're probably referring to, but it is kind of cool that the Dynasty guys and HK collabed so that each of us had a little special, like some logos and things throughout our jerseys, little Easter eggs, I guess.
I have a mustache in my name on the tee. On the tee, it's a big mustache on the tee. Yeah.
That's amazing, right? Like, I love how you do get your signature guns, right? Mm-hmm. You get your signature products, headbands, all that good stuff. And, like, that's an extension of you. It's amazing. And that's what it should be, right? And I think you guys are, like, absolutely headed in the right direction. And what I see is going to gravitate and blow the sport up. I would also argue, like, Nyjah Houston, right?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Are arguably one of the highest paid skaters of all time, the most iconic, like has set a new benchmark for where everyone needs to go.
Yeah.
Yep. Yep.
Right. Like, who came the closest to that in paintball? It's one guy.
Oliver.
Right? Oliver. Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. And I remember that like payday, right, that he got, and it was like, oh, he's making $100,000 a year or whatever it was, and it was like a landmark.
Yeah.
I would say that some company needs to make a big play like that.
Totally.
Mm-hmm.
And set up four players. I mean, it doesn't have to be four players, but maybe all, you know, and it's like pick someone from all different sects of paintball, right? Like, who's the most prominent woods guy? Is it Wolf? Make Wolf's life, elevate Wolf's lifestyle so he can be out promoting what paintball can do for you in the lifestyle. Pick you guys, get the pros, you know, super high profile pros, change somebody's life. Do media training, put a machine behind them, send them on a damn campaign. Man, when we do movies, like, I have to go on a campaign. I get media training. My girlfriend's a publicist. She runs me through the ringer. Don't say that. Say this. Do that. You know, it's amazing. Like, you know, there's so many different things you need to be educated on. And then it's like curate the venues, curate where you need to go.
There's layers, man. Absolutely.
Yeah. And Tyler, I've heard you say this, like, well, why is paintball not pop like that? It's not the guns. There's guns in the Olympics.
That's right. I always say that. I'm like, there's guns in the Olympics.
Shoot the target. I mean, these guys get so damn tired, they probably fall over and shoot their leg or something at some point. Like, that's not it, man. There's far, like, it's just no one's figured out how to make a profit on it yet. But yeah. once you elevate that, I believe once you elevate those like iconic players and show people there's a lifestyle at the end of this rainbow, it's going to entice so many more people to take that plunge into this game.
I couldn't say it any better than that. It just, and by God, I pray somebody out there listening can achieve this and help us push paintball where it needs to be so that it can blossom and be the sport that it's destined to be. It's going to, like Giovanni said, I'm sure you listened, it's going to save lives. Paintball is saving lives right now, truly, just because of where we're at in the global spectrum of everything that's going on. This game is something that is going to have the capacity to really get people out and having fun and feel good about it and be, you know, having a good time and staying healthy. And the world needs stuff like that. So if there's somebody out there that can land some monster thing and help us, please, by God, and let's go.
But Tyler, I would say this, man, like don't wait for somebody else. You guys do it. You guys are doing it. Mm-hmm. Right. And like, I would look at like what Bam did. Right, with CKY2K, yeah, right? He transcended the skate culture through a prank video, essentially, that was a hybrid skate video. Like, let's think about that, right? Yeah. Like, I've been telling my buddies, I've been joking around with them. I'm like, what if you were, like, walking through the mall, and all of a sudden it was, like, coin duel in 5, 4. They strap a pack on your ass, hand you a marker, and you're, like, in a used car parking lot. Going down, right? Like, there's 2 out of 3. Let's win those coins. Like, that's the kind of like things I would be thinking of outside the box. Is like,
stuff
okay,
that goes viral. How can we get eyes on it?
Yes, dude. Yeah, I mean, look at like Mr. Beast, right? Like that dude, like fills a freaking swimming pool with jellies. 24 million views.
Mr. Beast, I'm not familiar with that one.
Oh, he crushes it. Yeah.
What does he do?
Yeah, crushes but it's. It. He fills a swimming pool with jellies and goes swimming in it, dude. Like, I don't know.
But jellies?
He just does random things.
They're like, you know those like dinosaurs that like swell in water?
Okay.
Like, I don't know what they're called. My brother has kids.
Yeah.
But dude, he just does like prank videos. He's like, goes, oh, I'm going to give $10,000 to a homeless person. I'm going to go give away a house. Like, he just does crazy stuff like that. And it's like, okay, the problem with paintball, right? Like, I think Dizon does an amazing job, right, with this content.
Amazing.
I think he's super talented. But like, the problem is, he's only talking to paintball players. Okay, well, how do you reel that audience in from other people, right? Like, we just can't stay in our own ecosystem. Like, we have to branch out, and that would come through entertainment.
And right? I will say that he is connecting with what I was talking about with like the video game culture really well. And he's also in there. So that I do love that, because honestly, Esham, I think that that's like one of our best ways of navigating this. You just got to like do what works, right? Don't work hard, work smart, do what's already kind of laid out in front of us. And then we can kind of, I mean, I don't care if we coattail on that thing to some promised lands, you know what I mean? It could happen.
Dude, absolutely, man. And like, and I think like what's happening now with the resurgence of 10 man mechanical and like getting more of those gentlemanly players back into the sport. I can't even tell you how many reunions of long lost friends I have had because of Tim and his vision for Iron City and what that beget to this world, man. I can't even tell you, man. Like literally I just had one last weekend, and I don't know if you guys know Whitney Pierce.
Yeah, of course.
He's playing Iron Kids.
Yeah.
So Red. Wit is the man.
He finally pulled Wit back into the game after 17 years, and we had a little outsiders reunion, and had him out to play. Man, it was fantastic. Man, big love to that dude.
Oh, Wit's the man. He's great. Always times.
Absolutely. You know, one thing I will say about the video game culture, I don't know that a lot of those video gamers would enjoy coming to play paintball, because it's an in-your-face game that you're forced to deal with repercussions right away. And video gamers, they're so used to like, oh, I lose, I quit, turn the TV off. You know, and it's like, for better or worse, I mean, the video game culture obviously is massive, but it's so easy to not confront your failures in the video game world. And I think like paintball is, I played a lot of sports, I don't know that there's any sport that is more like in your face when you make a mistake and telling and
just football, I think, and like hockey, you know, those that you get wrecked in those kind of sports too.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah.
So, but do you guys, either of you play video games right now?
Yeah, I dabble, but I'm a dad, so I don't get to do anything that I want to do.
I play sports video games. Yeah, so I played a lot of 2K. I honestly, since we started this show, I have not played many video games. We kind of work our butts off at night. And yeah, so I haven't played much, but the game I used to always play was NBA 2K. I played that religiously for so long.
But it's amazing. Like, you guys have found like an overdrive gear, right? Like, just when you think you reach your threshold, and like, oh, I can't do any more to get any better at this game. It's like, oh no, actually, there is a few more gears left in the transmission there. Like, I remember when I was like way into Xbox, right? I get this Xbox and I'm at home and I'm playing this thing religiously. And I have a hyper competitive disorder where I'm playing Modern War. And the thing is like, okay, if I get in this room, I'm playing it religiously. And if I get in this room, like, I've got to finish in the top three. Right? That's what the little mantra I'd say to myself. And then, okay, I got to do that twice. Now I got to do it three times. But long story short, after I'd memorized the maps and was having some success on this game, I discovered, and these games should be like Vegas rules. They should not have any tally. I discovered the tally. And I'd had the system for 3 months. And it said I had played for 29 days in 3 months. I unplugged that sucker, walked down to my neighbor, with the controllers, everything. I just bought the system 3 months ago. I said, how much will you give me for this? He goes, I don't know, $75. I just paid like $350 for that. I go, yep, here you go. Merry Christmas, dude. I do not need this in my life anymore.
That's funny.
Because it hits it hits so many of the sweet spots that paintball does, right? It's like uber competitive, first person shooter, only you don't have to leave your house and get dirty, and it's a lot cheaper. So but ultimately I just want to play the game of paintball. So I distilled that down in my life.
Hey, we're right there with you. Absolutely. That's all we want to do is run around on that paintball field. I mean, people, you know, if you can play paintball once a month, if you're lucky to play once a week, you could see the change in your life. It is a life changer. You just feel better after you play paintball. I don't know what the science is on it, but you just do. You just feel great.
That's great. Ooh, exercise.
And like, try wearing exactly, to Marcel's point, like, try wearing a Garmin device while you play. Dude, you get up, you start playing at 9, you finish at like 4 or 5, you're burning like 1800 calories.
Yep.
Have you done that? It's crazy. It's a massive burn.
If you track it, paintball, man, you don't realize it. You know, you think that you're just running around there and, you know, shooting paintballs around, but you're working hard to get those shots.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You're using your whole body in every movement. You're using all of the muscles in every part of your body. Mm-hmm. So it's fantastic. Feel great after a day of
hands. Well, for me, it's like a perfect merger of tech and sport and teamwork, right? So you get, for those techies, like, I like mountain biking, things like that, but paintball fills that void for me. It gives me the tech, gives me the gizmos, and then it also, you know, the team aspect and then the athleticism of it all. It has every quadrant for me.
Absolutely.
I've never thought about that, but you're right. It does have it's like being a race car driver. You got to work on your car, make sure it's all dialed in, ready to go.
Well, according to Little John, he lets Bob work on his car.
Yeah, I mean, it's true. Bob, that was the best. I would always build my own guns at Bob Long's shop when I was like young. I would go to the bay and like just go and work on my Intimidator. I still think back on that. I'm like, what the hell? How did I get so lucky to be able to like go and hang out at Bob Long's factory and build my own paintball guns? It's just crazy.
Yeah. But can we I want to talk about that for a second, because I think that's amazing, right? That you had this mentor in Bob, right?
Yeah.
And that team. And like, several other gentlemanly paintballers along the way, right? And you're a young man and your path can be anywhere, right? And I'm sure, Marcelo, you had the same experience. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
It's like, true, man. I do think that I would love to welcome some of that older demographic back into the game, right? Like, to have those relationships. I remember like there was a dude on my team back in the day. And honestly, like, I was a broke kid making $400 every 2 weeks working at a photo lab. This is when you have, you know, cameras actually took pictures on film and negative. And it took every nickel I had to play for the weekend or to keep my Otakocker in parts or whatever it might be. And like, we had to go win or I couldn't play the next weekend. You know, it was like that. I was that on the edge, right? Like, my parents supported paintball, but they weren't going to pay for it in any way, shape, or form. They're like, oh, you want to do this, you know, expensive hobby? You go out there and do that, kid.
Yeah, you got to hustle. I'm with you, bro. We got to welcome the OGs back with what, like, let's all play paintball again, whether it's 10 man or just showing up at our local fields and, you know, reigniting the culture of the sport, because that demographic that you're talking about brings so much value to the paintball community. There's so much a wealth of knowledge and just passion for paintball that might be sitting dormant that we need back out at the paintball fields to, you know, keep it reinvigorated and keep this thing thriving.
Absolutely, man. No, and it's a great look. I get great joy out of giving back to the sport now, right? Because I see myself going from the 15-year-old kid to the 43-year-old man now, right? And it's like, oh, it's interesting to be seeing both sides of that coin, right? And people I thought were ancient when I started playing, it's like, oh, I'm that guy.
Absolutely.
It's a blessing, bro. It is. It's amazing.
It comes back.
So I want to know.
It's funny. Yeah, real quick, Ty, because now we're kind of in the position that, you know, when we were kids, we had, you know, these pro players that kind of took us under their wing. And it's like, you know, Ty, I know you have it as well, but I see these kids that come to our clinics or come out to these events, and it's just so full circle. Like, that's such a cool part of the game of paintball that's unique as well. You don't see that in other sports. I mean, you know, maybe some of the pros, of course, they mentor some of the kids, but it's not as accessible as it is in paintball. You know, it's so easy for the pros to integrate with just any player out there, you know, and that's what hooked me. And Ty, it's very similar with you. When I was a young kid, the pros were at my local field playing, and they would let me just jump on and randomly play with them or play against them. They would give me advice. You know, I could ask them questions. And these were my role models, people that I looked up to. I had their posters hanging up in my bedroom, you know, and I could go and talk to them on the weekends. And that sparked this whole thing of, I want to be just like them. I want to follow that same path, that same dream, you know, and that's a unique thing that we have in paintball. And so it's good to see. You are seeing a lot of the pros really embrace that role a lot more now than they did before. And it's an amazing thing. I think that will pay dividends, you know, in the years to come. But it's man, there's so many reasons to love our sport. There really is.
Well, and if there is a silver lining to the pandemic, right? It's what you just said, right? Yeah. Like that's what's come out of it to me is more involvement with those upper echelon players. That they've come back down and then said, hey, you know what? I can't be playing paintball, but I still want to be in the sport that I love. So how can I do that? How can I build my community? And it's been really amazing to see that happen.
That was how we played paintball for a while. Like, we literally, because the way our schedule works with paintball is it never stops. So we're always, you know, doing some facet of paintball nonstop. So when that happened, it was like, we had to rethink, like, what do I do with my life now? Like, what do I do? So
started a podcast. So
that was it. It was like, we're still playing here. You know, we're playing the game. We called it Play the Game. We still wanted to play the game. And we just took it into the metaverse, you know?
Like, if we can't play paintball, we're going to talk about paintball.
Yeah.
So that brings me to something I wanted to explore. And, you know, no pressure, guys. Not like I'm going to ask you around the show or anything. But I kind of already jumped the water with Tyler. So he kind of probably knows what's coming. But I'm super intrigued to see what the day-to-day grind is of a pro, right? Mm-hmm. Like, I want to spend a week with you dudes and, like, go document that process. Like, what you do in the gym to prepare, what you're doing, you know, to fuel your intellect and your gameplay and all that good stuff. And, like, and then to get some of your lifestyle in there, man.
Let's do it.
And then to crescendo that, like, I'd love to sort of, like, as the guinea pig, try to even echo what you're doing, right? Like, let me go do that gym workout with you guys. And then we can do a coin duel at the end where I can lose all my coins.
Okay, I see. You had an ulterior motive there, you know? You wanted to get in on the
action. Coin duel.
No, but honestly, like, it would, you know, look, I think it would be interesting for me to just even try to catch up with you guys and hang.
I love
and,
it.
And I'd have a, I'd have so a blast much. Doing it. And I want to take, like, those guys like yourselves that, like, eat, drink, and sleep it, right? Like you're, I'm sure you're doing specific movements to make your paintball play better, right?
That's right.
Like you're doing in the park, like Tyler, I know you do a bunch of like leaping exercises and stuff like that. Like I really want to try that, man, because I'm intrigued with anything that will make my game better. Like I'm literally going to go take parkour because I want to learn how to fall better.
Hell yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
That's cool.
Like, I got a shoulder injury and I was like, you know what? I don't want this to happen again. So I'm going to take some like tumbling classes, learn how to fall better. And maybe like, I want to take the movements that we do in the game, show them, because this is what I did with my physical therapist. I'm like, hey, this is what I'm doing in the game. And they're like, well, don't do that for 6 months. But I want to take that to a parkour like specialist and have them break down and say, oh, but maybe you can do it better this way or try something new.
Talk about progression. Talk about pushing the boundaries. That's what I'm talking about, Ashton. Let's go.
That's such a valuable thing. And I talk about the fact that I did Taekwondo and different mixed martial arts when I was younger, a lot on the show. I've never talked about that part of it though. In Taekwondo, especially learning how to fall was like a massive thing. We did so many different drills of learning how to fall, like in case you get thrown. And honestly, I think it helps tremendously. Like I knock on wood, you know, I've had major knee injuries that were from basketball when I first started. And, you know, I don't know if I've said that on the show. People used to think that it happened from paintball. I just kind of like, yeah. I hurt myself practicing, but I was playing basketball. And it was when I first got into basketball and I just had no clue what I was doing. I was going up for rebounds against dudes. I had no business going up for rebounds. I was 110% effort with no understanding of body awareness in that sport. But other than that, outside of those injuries, there's been so many times where like, whether it's a trip or a slight fall where I'm like, I should have been seriously injured, you know? And I don't, you kind of fall gracefully. Your body knows how to absorb that impact. That's a really valuable thing for paintball. Cause we're throwing ourselves into the ground over and over and over. You're running around and not very level arenas often, you know? So that is a valuable skill. And dude, parkour, that's so badass.
Yeah.
You're gonna be able to be Spider-Man out there, you know, jumping all over the bunkers. That's gonna be pretty tight, dude. I gotta see this.
I don't know that I want to go, you know, somersaulting off of two-story buildings or scaling anything rowdy, dude. I just want to like get on the field and not hurt myself and move a little bit better.
climb over one of the big bricks.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Like I think those sort of displays of athleticism are impressive. And I would honestly say like, think about like skateboard culture, right? They're always out like getting clips. Mm-hmm. Like what I would say, like, why don't we do that in paintball?
Explain getting clips.
Getting clips, like, so you as a skateboarder, you go out and you film every day, right? You bring your filmer, you're working on your part. And so you're doing tricks and you may only learn that trick for like one moment, but it's caught on film and then it goes in your highlight reel or your tape at the, you know, whatever company you're skating for at that time. Yeah. And I know, Tyler, you're doing something for Monkey with a Gun, right? But like that should be happening all the time. Like you should be out there getting impressive clips and putting them up all the time and doing like a badass highlight reel. Dude, that would make or break skaters. They get one iconic part, one iconic trip or trick, boom, you're done. You would blow up throughout the entire culture.
That's right. No, you're right. The videography, we could definitely take that to new heights in paintball. And there are some that are, you know, doing a really good job at it, but we can always be better, man. We can always be pushing the limits and getting more for the culture of the game. Always.
The only difference is that in paintball, there is no like fundamental, you can go out and film some amazing trick shots or even amazing skill sets. It's a mental game. And until you step on the field and outsmart the person on the other side of the field, your relevancy in the sport isn't quantified. Right? Like it is, it's hard to capture that on film when you're practicing. It's hard to, you know, unless you're filming all of your 5-on-5s, which again, you know, the way you are trying to film it and the way you filmed your practices, maybe you could do something like that. But the game of paintball is up here. It's in between the ears, you know, and it's about making better decisions than your opponent. That's really what separates the good from the great and what separates people throughout the divisions. It's not athleticism, although that plays a role and it helps you execute your decisions much, much more efficiently, much better. You look at the best players in the world. They're also the best athletes in the sport, right? So they do kind of go hand in hand, but It's all up. It's the mental stuff. So how would you capture, how can you capture that, I guess, is my question. How can mm-hmm. we find a way to capture that? Because that's the chess game.
Like on a day to day.
Yeah. Like that's the chess game. That's what makes these players so great, you know, are these big moves and reading the field and seeing these openings.
Mm-hmm. What, just remember that one where you had Ollie going down, you know, streaking through the middle of the field and shooting four players, right?
ESPN. Yeah.
Like, right. Or I remember like even the silly thing where like those guys used to throw up two paintballs and shoot them both out of the air. Like when first happened, honestly, we're like, that's not possible. How that's if I could cut that somehow. Sorry if I'm cussing, but that's not possible.
But what's weird is they did cut that in the serial in that video.
There's a cut, right?
Do you remember that he had two different loaders, or I forgot what it was, but like there was two different. It was either a jersey or do you know what I'm talking about, Tyler? Certainly you do, right?
Yeah, yeah. I know. I'm not sure what that was.
I forgot what the distinction was, but yeah. So when he threw up and I've seen Oliver throw two paintballs up and shoot it, so I know he can. But for some reason in that video, that was an edited piece, which was like crazy because it was an obvious distinction. They had like a different loader in the two separate shots. But it's funny. I see this kid, Colton, that comes out and plays on New York Wrecking Crews on Team USA, he can throw up two paintballs and shoot them out of the air. And I'm like, dude, that's really cool. You know, it's like something that for sure is visually like it, you show those videos to the general public and they say, holy shit, that looks really hard. Like I need to catch it on film because I haven't filmed it yet, but I can kick a paintball up and I'll shoot it. Right. Like stuff like that, I think is I think people that don't understand paintball would be like, whoa, that's sick. You know, that's takes skill.
Yes. Yeah. Dude, you have to do that. That's your next clip. Get it.
Yeah.
I just watched some like, you know, soccer kid doing all kinds of insane dribbles, but he's not doing those in the game. They're too flashy, right? But he's got his buddy out there and he's just taking him to task, you know, doing little heel kicks and stuff over his pal. It just looks dope.
You're absolutely right. And even us, like just filming our drills, there's hundreds of drills we can do. And just filming those, just doing those, the way that we do them, it probably is a lot different than the way that the mass public would do that same drill. So just being able to watch us do things as well is extremely valuable because it shows technique in the shot, in the choices and all those kind of things.
Absolutely. And unfortunately, look, guys, like where the sport is right now, you have to be your own media machine, right?
Oh, that's right.
Yeah. Until you don't, and that's then bam, you're done. Then you get Nike paint and they're sponsoring your part, you know, and they're giving you a paycheck, and then you get the mansion, and then you're living the Nigel life.
And then you get the mansion. Dude, we want to be our own mansion.
Just running it.
I mean, and you guys could literally do that right now, right? Like think about this, right? You put all, like, Team Dynasty used to roll that house.
Yeah,
I would pay to watch that. I would pay to watch that. Put that as a, you know, like all you do in a house for a weekend and document that, please. I'll watch that right now. It'll be hilarious.
I know. And you know, we need something like that. That's actually one of our amazing teammates from our Discord, where if you want to, you know, really become a part of this show, join the Discord. It's cracking off in there. We're having a lot of fun. He was kind of hitting on that with his question. It was in regards to your films, like you directed shorts and then you directed feature length films. You started off with shorts and then went into features. And this is from Steve, AKA Stavi Beats. that's his nickname. He was wondering how much changed in the level of behind the camera production from short to feature, and how, you know, Go Sports can go in that kind of same direction, or if we can implement, you know, having behind the scenes footage of teams like that, or whatever we can do to really, you know, nurture the video aspect of what we're doing.
So hold on. So the shorts compared to the feature films, because those are two hugely different endeavors, right? I mean, the feature films that I'm doing now have 100 plus crew members. Right. Yeah. So when we started off doing those shorts with my brother and a very intimate crew, I mean, we were doing like four or five people. I mean, my brother and I did, you know, we would shoot the video, we would light it, we would do the sound. One of us would hold the boom mic while the other one was doing the camera. I mean, very, very humble beginnings. I mean, I remember we shot a feature film with a with a 4-person crew. And we made it for $1,500. And so my mom catered it all. This is way back in 2004, but my mom catered it all. My brother and I shot it and or held the sound equipment. And my dad lit it with a Coleman lantern from Walmart and a bounce car. And so we had no money, right? You have $1,500 to shoot this movie. So we're like, how are we going to shoot this movie? We should just do it in nature, in a forest. So we wrote a script for the woods. And we're like, okay, 5 junior college kids go to the woods on a camping trip and mayhem ensues, right? It's not a great movie, but it's how we cut our teeth and how we figured out how to make movies.
That's right. That's right. Yeah. And that's what he was really trying to, the question was around, you know, how much behind the camera production changed between the shorts and the feature. Yeah.
Yeah. Dude, so like Fat Man, you kept fast forward to Fat Man, which is, you know, almost $10 million. You know, you got 125 crew members. You have every department.
Let's name drop.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm glad it's better than you than me, Marcel. but you have every department like has so many different rungs in the ladder, right? So you have your production designer, your art director, then you have your set dressers and your set painters. And oh man, it's just crazy. Heck, all that all breaks down. And so you just become a sort of a delegator, right? You're trying to get everybody to be cohesive in the same movie.
Yeah. So. And you also had Walton Goggins. He's big time too in Fat Man.
Dude, do you enjoy Walton?
Yeah.
From Vice Principals and all that good stuff.
He's a beast, man. He is.
I gotta tell you, like, honestly.
What was it like working with some of these stars, these personalities? You know, I mean, you're in the thick of it in Hollywood. So curious. I know so many people are curious what that's like.
Yeah.
Well, no two actors are the same, right? So it's like very much like paintball, right? No two players are the same. And so you have to get on there and do what Malcolm Gladwell talks about is like thin slice people, right? We've all done it.
Yep.
You get on there, you go, hey, how do I collaborate with this person to get the best out of them and work within their parameters while both working towards the same goal? And that's it, right? So then it's once you, and you just be open and honest and in it to win it, right? And my brother and I do these movies with my brother. So my brother Ian and I are dysfunctionally codependent. We've been working together since the beginning in this movie business, and I couldn't do it without him, and I'd like to think he'd say the same thing about me.
Yeah, I love that. And that's so cool that you guys do that together, man. Like that's huge.
Dude, I mean, so many people are like, how do you work with your sibling? And I just think we're just blessed, right? And we grew up in a rural environment. So it was like, get along or be really lonely. And then we both discovered like a mutual love of cinema. And it came from just, every weekend, we would walk down to the video store. And there were so many goat heads out in rural Woodlake, California. So I'm from the Central Valley, much like yourself, Tyler. And you couldn't even ride a bike without getting 2 flat tires and you're going to Walmart for some new tubes. So we had to open down to the video store and we cleaned this thing out, man. So every weekend was between 6 and 12 movies, a box of 2 dozen donuts. And we would go back to the house on Saturday, knock out the chores because we had my parents own like a ranch, right? So that's got like, you got to haul sprinklers, dig trenches, mend fence, feed horses. It's crazy. It's a nightmarish. Yeah. Don't go there. Don't do it, guys. and so we would pound the chores out, and then we would just watch movies all night into Sunday and do about 12 movies a weekend. And it was never a career, right? It was just a passion. We just loved movies. And, you know, they were made in this faraway land, and it was a magical process that we had no idea how it happened.
That's crazy. So wait, what video store did you guys go to? You remember the name of it?
I want to say it's called Woodlake Video in downtown Woodlake, not anything flashy. There was 2 of them. One had an arcade and then the other one did not. But, at one point I remember we had rented out almost every English language title. So we were dipping into some of the Spanish titles, and I don't speak Spanish, not even a lick.
That's awesome. So the city is Woodlake where you grew up?
Yeah, so it's around like Visalia, Bakersfield area. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
So absolutely. In between Fresno and Bakersfield is Visalia, and that's where I'm from, that area, nice. Wood Lake, all in that area. So Three Rivers. And
they had a paintball field that was in a vicinity, or no, that was like later on when you got into paintball.
I mean, all right. So you guys just want to do it? You want to like go back real quick? I'll try to like jam through it.
100%. Yeah. Let's get back into like, how you started, how you got into the game.
But wait, before we do that, one last tangent, or I can't promise this will be the last one, but it'll be a tangent. So we need a paintball movie, boys.
Yes, yes, we do. No, we're going to get to that. Don't you worry.
Let's go.
Legitimate movie. Yes. And I've got a take. I've got an idea. I've been ruminating. I've been jotting it down. I got a Word doc going.
Ooh.
I want to do something like Friday Night Lights and mid-90s, only it's contemporary, right? But that's just the flavor.
Wow.
It's not about winning World Cup. You know, that's not the story. This story is about the bonds. It's about the people.
I guess we can't be in it then.
Well,
I'm just kidding, dude. I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding.
Alex said he wanted to be like the manager that fires someone. So yeah, I don't know.
Alex would be great at that. Alex would be so good at that. Just comes in there with his clipboard. Yeah,
and we're talking about Alex Frazee, the boss, the big hog, you know, the one and only.
But just so you know, that iron is in the oven, and I'm working on it.
Yeah, talk to us a little more. Then you know, I would love to get into this.
Yeah,
This is the whole. This is what I'm super fascinated with. Let's chat.
The paintball lineage or the movie? Which one?
The movie. Okay. Like so, this is, you know, so that's what we love to take.
Yeah, I would love to take some of the more like relationship aspects of the game that I came up with, right? So like I said, I had this dude, right? He mentored me. He facilitated my paintball. He made it possible for me to come play paintball. And I remember we would take 16-hour drives up to Portland, Oregon to go play in the middle of the woods. And I'd be riding shotgun with him. And he would deal me life lessons, man. Like, like real world, like, I don't know, just really interesting, like how to grow up. I mean, I had my first sushi dinner with this guy, right? I drank my first Sapporo, you know, like it was like all these firsts, you know. And then we'd get up there with the rest of the guys, and we'd all have an amazing weekend playing paintball. I think I want it like. Tackle some of the archetypes of paintball, right? So you have that older mentor player, you have a young player who isn't able to necessarily afford the game. Maybe his home environment isn't great, but he's amazing at this game.
Yes.
And he needs someone to help him play it, right?
Yeah.
You have maybe the guy's wife. You have a gentleman who's maybe on the bubble with his wife, right? She doesn't understand why he dedicates so much of his time to this pointless endeavor, right? Where is it going? What are you doing it for? Like, these are the sort of like archetypes I'd like to tackle for the game.
Yeah,
dude,
no, you're not wrong. There's so many of them.
I just envisioned this whole movie, this whole scene. I even got like the filters of the of the screen in my mind. But it's like, dude, that is the beauty of paintball. Those experiences, those relationships, the way it's raised us, the way the game has raised us, to me, that is the beauty of the game. And if we could find a way to capture that and present that story, I love what you said, like Friday Night Lights. It's not about winning the biggest tournament in the world. It's not about the glam or the glory. It's about the raw emotional connection to the game and the relationships that are built within the sport. Dude, please, let's make this happen. I don't know if there's anything we could do to help and assist in this, man. That I think that would be huge. That would be huge.
You guys are going to get the call, man. The very least, I'd love to have you guys get in front of the camera. Maybe you can play the nemesis team, or just even some smaller parts throughout the ensemble. Like, why not? Right.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, definitely. I'll be a nemesis.
Like what you guys are doing now is acting, right? It just gives you parameters and you guys can fill in the blanks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that sounds like a ball of wax, so much fun. And just, you know, that is going to explode and do really well. Cause there's so many, anytime that somebody does something in paintball, you see the support. I mean, every single time paintball has been somewhere that it needs support, whether it's in a streaming platform, on a, you know, a social network, on TV, whatever, the numbers are through the roof, and they will be if something like this comes to fruition as well. You know, there's going to be a ton of support outpouring for it.
Yeah, I'm really excited to delve in, even, you know, on a lot of short form stuff too. And look, man, there's a big gap between feature film endeavors, unfortunately. And so when I'm in that like writing development phase with my brother, I personally love to keep busy with stuff. And and I think going out and chasing my other passion, which is paintball, and filling that gap is it's wonderful for me. It's a true enjoyment.
Woohoo! Let's go, Esham. This is amazing, man. I love that, dude. I can't wait to cook up.
And also, this is live for the world to hear, so we're holding you accountable. So we can't wait. I better see it in AMC theaters in the next couple of years.
Well, let me tell you, so like, just to put it in perspective, Batman was a 14-year journey.
Whoa.
Wow.
Dude, so every movie is, it's a marathon. And so, you know, they take as long as they take, but my brother and I were relentless, never give up. And, we're dogged in our pursuits. So once we grab a hold, there's no letting go.
Honestly, I love that about paintball too, though. We have so many people like yourself that are experts in other fields, but have a love for the game of paintball. And, and the more people like you that can, you know, marry the two and bring more light to the game. I mean, dude, it's an amazing thing. It's a beautiful thing. We have a ton of opportunity because of that, you know, because again, we have so many people that paintball's their passion. They might love it, but they do other stuff and they're experts in other fields. And so, man, it's just cool to have people like you in the community, man. So hell yeah, dude.
Yeah. I really enjoyed High Tones.
Yeah,
episode.
Exactly.
That was a good one.
And then Chris, the football player, right?
Chris Odom. Shout out.
Yeah.
Shout out to Chris Odom. Man,
great episodes, both of those. And honestly, LJ's episode as a player, Woodley. Yeah. Man, honestly, dudes, like some of the insight that he let out, like, oh, you know, when you like you bait low, like I took that straight to practice, started implementing it. Guys, I'm like, hey, bait low, then move, then bounce. What have we been doing?
Yeah, that's right. And to be honest, there's a ton of these little tricks that we have in our bags that we don't even really maybe consciously know we do, but we do them. And just giving those little tricks away like that is everything. And that's a great facilitator is like the show is getting all these little tricks out so that it raises the level up, you know?
But dude, it's interesting, right? Like before we got on here, they're like proprietary, right? Like, oh, we don't want to give away the trade secrets. Like, I don't want to give you the secret sauce combo.
Yeah.
And I was like, part of that's natural, right? You're like, oh, I want to hold on to this stuff. But honestly, the other part of it is like, let's put it out there and let's all conspire together to pull this stuff off. And like, you know what? If you have tricks and you give them to someone else, it's going to make you a better player because you're going to learn new ones. It's just pushing you to be in every way, shape, or form.
That's so true. Absolutely. Yeah, because I know if I give all my tricks away, I can't not have any tricks of my own. You know, gotta keep something in the bag.
Yeah, I don't think you guys are gonna run out. I wouldn't worry about that.
Oh man, well, as long as we can still run around and have some fun and play paintball, I think you might be right, man. Because it's something that's a constant progression. Like even this very moment, as I sit here talking with you guys, I'm thinking of new ways that I can be a different version of myself and push myself, you know, past any boundaries that have been set before or that I set on myself. And it's something that is so inspiring, you know, to have a sport that can continually drive you, you know, and we can all connect on that regard of just like continually trying to be better people, better progression as players, as people, inhabitants of a planet, you know, all the way base level to the sky and just be the best that we can be for, you know, for the culture of paintball.
Man, I love it when people tell me I can't do something.
Yeah.
I absolutely love that. That's just coal in the furnace. And I'm just like, oh, good. Like, I can't go make movies. Oh, perfect. Tell me that more. Bring it on. Yeah.
Let's go.
Oh, I can't play this level of the game. Oh, great. Awesome. Please tell me that. It just gets my blood up. I'm getting after it. All right, you guys want to jump into how I got into this paintball game? And I'm sure more little tangents will come along the way as we go here. Mm-hmm. All right, so I graduated. I got to back it up from graduation. Sorry. And I graduated in 96. So 93, 94, it's my sophomore year. And I'm utterly consumed with skateboarding. That's it. I eat, drink, and sleep skateboarding. And nothing else in the world really matters at that point. And I go, and so my dad has a photography studio in downtown Visalia. And every day after school, I go skateboarding until it gets dark, and then I come back. And there's a magazine store called Midtown News that I would skate down to every day. I get my every month I get my Thrasher, my skateboarding weekly, whatever our monthly is going to be. And I would go in that magazine store, and I would just peruse the racks. And I remember, bang, Action Pursuit Games right there. It just gets my attention. So I start leafing through Action Pursuit Games while I'm getting my skateboard magazines. And it took a couple months. And I remember I proposed the idea to my dad. My dad's, you know, typical, you know, red-blooded American, loves his guns, you know, likes to do all that stuff. He's not a too big of a maniac about it, but he was like, you know, an impressive shot and could do stuff and show us guns. I said, hey, Dad, you know, what do you think of this paintball game? And he lit up, right? Like I'd come to, because he wasn't ever a fan of skateboarding, but like, something with a gun, bring it, right? We're going to hunt each other in the woods. I get to hunt my kids. Perfect, son. And so there was a guy, his name was John, and he had just closed down his field in Visalia, California. And he, in the Thrifty Nickel, had listed some VM68s. He got like all of his rental guns were like VM68s, these PMI3s, and they're semi-auto like AK-47s. You guys know what this gun is?
Like a big
heavy spider that would literally like knock you out if you weren't careful. And so we got these semis from John, and my dad's in there, and we get three of them. So we get crossfire mass, three VM68s, and my dad goes, oh, what about that fill station? He like buys the fill station right there. So we're all kitted. We go out to my parents' house, and they have 10 acres of land, but in the back up next to like a river, there's like maybe like an acre or so that's kind of feral and like filled with woods. And we go back there, and it was amazing, right? So I'm with my dad. We buy like a case of paint for like $120 of like Powerball or something like that, you know? And we go in the backyard, and my dad proceeds to demolish my brother and I in a two on one for like hours on end, right? And he's doing all the tricks, right? Like he's hiding in the bushes. We're looking around. He's rolling and shooting down the hills, doing all kind of crazy stuff. We're having a blast, right? Just playing in the backyard. And I remember my parents didn't love skateboarding. And I was like skateboarding, paintball. Paintball started to come up, and skateboarding's like starting to ebb. And then I remember one time they're like, I got grounded, you know, probably bad grades or something. My dad's like, you can't skateboard anymore for a month. And I remember I just took that skateboard and I just stomped it in half and I handed it to him. I said, that's fine. I'm done with skateboarding. And that was it, man. I honestly, that summer just switched full blown paintball. No looking back. Everything was paintball from that day forward. So I start calling all my friends. I'm convincing them to get guns. They're buying like Tippmanns or whatever it might be, right? Like low level guns. And we're in the backyard, and the posse is growing. So it's like my brother on my dad, then like two of my friends on my dad. Then like there's like six or seven of us at one point on my dad. And he's still continuing to beat us. It's six or seven.
It's no way.
Marcel, try not to judge. I know.
I mean, I'm just saying Pops must have been pretty damn good.
That's what, yeah. Dang, that guy, he must have been known what he was doing out there. Yeah.
You know what? He was strategic. He'd find the biggest. Yeah, he'd go find a nice big tree with his back to the river and then make us all come towards him through the gauntlet, you know?
Yeah.
And I remember we finally dug him out because one of us decided it was a great idea. We would just wade through the river and go get him. Right. So we would like, if I remember, it was like straight up commando Rambo through the river. Ends up, you know, shooting my dad. But when he got out, all of the paintballs had fused together in his pack and hopper. So he just like shot those last two shots. And that was the end of his day.
That's so, but
from this sort of like recreational roots, I got interested in the tournament stuff because I was seeing that in the magazines. Right. And so I remember I was like, okay, well, where are they playing tournaments? Like, what are we doing? And then this is like at the time where they had a machine shop in high school.
Yeah.
And so I took my VM.
How long did you play recreational style for before you really got into the tournament? I'm curious because I played rec style before I got into tournament as well. It was like, maybe like, I don't know, 6 months or so for me.
Yeah, that's what it was for me too. About 6 months, you know, and then you know that tournaments stuff's out there. And if you're a competitive person, you're going to seek it out, right? You want to pit yourself against others. Yeah. And so I remember like, I was like trying to go into the stores and I went to Fresno. All right. So hold on. So I took my gun to machine shop and I just start cutting on it in machine shop. And I'm like milling stock. I'm like making stocks and like cutting down the barrel and like chopping it up. I didn't know if this thing was going to work or not after I got done with it, but it looked way dope. And so then we took it. My mom was like, the closest paintball field's in Fresno, which is like an hour away, or the shop. And I was like, okay, let's go. So we went up there and we went to the store and he's like, go out to the Broken Bridge in Fresno. And there was another place called the Slaughterhouse, which I didn't really ever know about.
That's where I started at, was at the Slaughterhouse. That was my very first time playing.
Yeah. And it's the one that's like cement, right? And it was all kind of hogged out.
Yes, yeah. It was like out of like that was my very first experience with paintball was at the Slaughterhouse. And
yeah,
dude, it was like a dream. I was in a dream. It felt like it was not real. I was running in this cement building and there was all this wooded area all around it. And it was like a straight up video game is what it felt like. And it was the best day of my life. I still, like, I was young. I was like 11 or 10, but I still have these pictures in my mind from running around out there. And like, just the moments out there were timeless, just crazy.
Dude, it's crazy, right? And like, so there's no woods around this slaughterhouse that I played at, which makes it even better because there's two iconic paintball places called the Slaughterhouse. You know, there's one in like every region. They probably weren't even slaughterhouses.
I know, huh? Yeah.
But I just love that. So then we got to the Fresno. We're introduced to like the Fresno tournament circuit, which is a little bit bigger, or paintball community, which is a little bit bigger, but not super big. And I remember some of the guys that I still play with to this day, I met out there and was just playing rec ball, Broken Bridge, you know, bushes in the river, all that stuff. And I was introduced to some guys in my neighborhood that we all formed like a kids team called Aces High.
Yeah.
And so it was like one kid was like 13. I think, you know, I was a junior at that point. So what is that? 17. My brother.
That's a great name. I love the name. That's great.
I remember I couldn't afford, I'm 15 or 16 years old. So my dad sold his photography business and I started working for, and we needed to get paintballs, right? And equipment and stuff like that. And I was like, gosh, it's so expensive. How do I do this? And I remember calling Tasso. You guys remember Tasso? Old legacy paintball company. I remember calling them and presenting my dad's photography business license to get cost discount. And luckily, Isaac at the time was like, oh, you know, and I'm like a 16-year-old kid with my voice hasn't even, you know, matured yet. And he's like, yeah, I'll hook you up, guy. Don't worry. Like, is the package going? So we started Aces High. We're driving around with a bunch of guys playing, like, I think we played like Vegas. So you can imagine 15, 16-year-old kids being chaperoned by a really irresponsible adult in Vegas in a motorhome. It was a ruckus and a good time. And honestly, from that, like those early days playing with Aces High, I was like, this is the sport for me, right? We were not good. We were getting smoked by the paraplegic turtles.
Yeah. They were good, though. They were good, the paraplegic turtles.
Dude, they were good.
Yep.
Yeah. Dale, like, dude, Dale would throw down, man. Those guys were good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so I remember, like, so just keeping grinding with it. And I remember at one point, there was a local team called Strike Force and it was captained by Mike Poindexter. And he like saw some of us Aces High guys and he was like, hey, and he was smart, right? He didn't cherry pick like the players that he wanted. He just said, I want all of you guys to come join my organization. And so it was like, oh, like five of us kids came over to his organization and they were growing the organization. And so they had just won novice in the Great Western Series. So they had just won novice in the Great Western Series and they were going to do amateur and novice the next year. And they had done They were like one of the first teams to ever do like jerseys that were not camo. Mm. And they were like purple and black or something like that. And they were like motocross jerseys.
What year was this? Like, this has got to be okay.
95-ish. Yeah, it's wow. It's a little dodgy for me, but I think it's 94, 95. Yeah. But we went to a Vegas. So I remember just seeing them rocking these jerseys. So I got on the team, and I remember I'd practiced with them for months, right? A few months, and they did put it to a vote, and I just like didn't make the amateur team. And they're like, "Oh, you know, Esh, like, you're there, but we want to put you on the novice team, like for a couple of tournaments. There's a lot of guys have been playing, so you got to work your way up, kid." And I'm like, "Yeah, okay, I get it, no worries." And I remember, guys, like I was like the rated rookie on this novice team, and I went out there and I played like garbage. I couldn't walk 5 feet from the start station without getting hit. I would be like, and the horns go. I take 5 shots. At this point, I had like, you know, auto mag. I think I purchased an auto mag. And honestly, guys, like, I couldn't. Yeah, dude, it was huge. Crown point power feed. You know,
yep.
I could get all of like 4 or 5 balls out before I'd pinch one. Because those guns needed like the 4-speed loaders that we have now. They were starting to do it with those VL2000s.
Yes. Yes.
But I remember like going out and like after playing lights out in practice for like a couple weeks or months, there it was, and just playing my garbage, just being G1 literally every single game, and going back to the hotel and just totally crestfallen. And I remember sitting there in the team huddle. And I'll never forget it. One of the guys, he's like, "Well, if somebody hadn't played like trash the entire day, maybe we wouldn't have lost every game." And honestly, dude, like that was so cutting. I just remember sitting there being like, and just, you know, tears, man, because it meant so much to me at that time. It was like, I was putting everything I could into it, and just to have that showing. And so it was literally such a devastation because the novice team and the amateur team both got smoked out. And so the whole Strike Force organization collapses, literally collapses. They go from like a 25 player roster to 4. Whoa, me, wow. The captain, and 2 other dudes. And I remember like, and Mike was like, "Well, it's all gone. We're going to go try to play another event in Utah. And we're going to have to pick up a guy there." And I'm like, "Oh, okay. Like, whatever. Like, I'm in, Mike." So we drive up to Utah, and it's the 5 of us. And dude, honestly, talking about like the comeback, right? So like we win the event in Utah.
Yeah.
After the entire team had disbanded and like left the organization, and they were like, "Oh, the jerseys are too bright. They can see us through the woods. We're not playing in these jerseys." And like, we went and put those bright purple things on and went out and right in that back in that woods, and like won the next tournament.
Hell yeah.
And then you guys remember like a team called like Lynch Mob?
I've heard the team name, but
it's a team that
Little
John played on back in the day.
Yeah, that's right.
And then like there was a team, and then so anyways, I just remember like playing those guys there, and it's interesting. But so we ended up winning that tournament. We come back, and a buddy of mine that was on Strike Force came back, and he said, "By the way, we didn't beat Lynch Mob. They were an amateur."
Okay, I was just thinking. I was like, "You guys beat us." Yeah,
we did not beat them. They took somebody else to dethrone them.
Yeah.
But we come back to Visalia, and a buddy of mine goes, "Hey, I started playing with this team called Ground Zero." And I was like, "Oh, Ground Zero." He's like, "They have a full roster. They have 10 guys. They play out of Fresno. Would you like to come play with that team?" I'm like, "Absolutely. Like, it's a big organization. GZ. Like, I love Strong." Yeah, I love it. Yeah. But this is a GZ New York. This is a GZ West Coast, Central Valley. Mm-hmm. Have you heard of them, though?
Yeah, I have.
Yeah.
Just through, just because, like, Bob Long, when I was a kid, there were so many people in that camp from all over the place that had just stories from all these different experiences of playing different events prior to me being a kid and getting on, and then being able to like soak up from all those guys.
Honestly, it's weird because the Central Valley, like Fresno area, is like in a bubble, right? Yeah. Like there weren't a lot of pros in that area. They were all in like Mare Island or up north more with where you were at. Mm-hmm. But like where we were, it was like this no man land between South and North and West California. And so we were kind of on our own. We had like really no industry backing. which was a weird place to be, but it also bred this hunger in us to go out and like try to do something that hadn't been done out of that area before. So we take this Ground Zero team and we start playing the Great Western Series. And that's where we encounter Oliver, Alex, Ryan, Yosh, all those guys in the Great Western Series. And we're playing in the Mare Island and the Annis, and this sort of like rivalry sort of starts to heat up at that point. Mm-hmm. And we end up winning, like getting that team together. We end up winning like 10-man or something, novice. I can't remember what it was. It was like novice and amateur at that time. I can't remember how it delineated. And so we ended up winning novice. We got the jackets, which was like a landmark thing for all of us. We couldn't believe it. And then again, like anything, man, it's so weird. Like once we won that year, like half the team faded away. And they just didn't want, you know, like they lost interest or it became, you know, their focus was something else. And so I remember we teamed up with an older crew of dudes compared to ourselves, because we were all, you know, in our 20s at that time. And we even had Whit, and Whit was on the team. So he was like 15 or 16 year old kid at that time. So we were the old dudes at like 20, 19 and 20. And then Whit was like the kid, you know?
Yeah.
We teamed up with this other team called the Hammerheads, and we made Outsiders, which was the next evolution. And that was like 97 or 8, maybe 98. I think it was a 98. So GZ was 97 and 98 was Outsiders. And then that's when the rivalry between us and Lofty really heated up, because they were like we were battling each other out for the title that whole year. And I remember it came down to a match in at Camp Pendleton, and this is where you had before where we had to enter through the front of Camp Penn, not how you have to enter that side gate now. And it was in that like valley. You guys remember this field? But it's more wooded fields. And it's interesting to come full circle, because that's where I had that terrible game for Strike Force back in the day. That's where like the ultimate career embarrassment happened. And then to come back to this point and have the whole tournament series on the line, Lofty's winning, and they literally had to finish like second to the bottom, and we had to win it to get first. It was like impossible. And I remember I just remember a buddy of mine like was like, hey, I'm not gonna go. And I'm like, dude, you gotta go. And he's like, no, I'm not gonna go, we can't win anyways. And I'm like, he's like, I go, dude, I don't know, man, I just feel like we can win. And he's like, all right, Ash, good luck with that, right? He's like, it's impossible. There's no way Lofty's getting second to last or whatever they had to get for you guys to make that happen. And whatever, the miraculous happening, right, that happens is that exact scenario plays out, and we end up winning the jackets for that year, that 98 season. It was pretty miraculous. And dude,
who was all on the Lofty team?
I'd have to look. I don't know exactly, right? But I'm pretty sure Eric – played on that team. I'm pretty sure Oliver played on that team. I'm pretty sure Alex played on that team. I remember after not seeing Alex for a long time and running into him at, I had just gotten back into the sport in 2012, running into him at Camp Pendleton. I just came up into the pit, and I'm like, hey, what's up, guys? You probably don't remember me. I used to play with you guys back in the day on Ground Zero and Outsiders. And he looks at me and he goes, Outsiders? We had quite a rivalry back in the day. I'm like, oh man, he hates me. I'm like, yeah, we're all good, dude. I'll see you later.
Dude, that's epic. You got to play against some of the biggest names in paintball in the heyday. Like, those are some of the memories that I hear them still talk about. We had Yosh on the show. We have, you know, all these amazing paintball players from that area and that time. And they still, you know, hold the same type of nostalgic memories as well of the time.
Mm-hmm. It's like the muscle car era. Right? You guys are in the import racer era right now, but that was the muscle car era.
We're in the Tesla, era. The EV
era. You're right,
you're
past the import racer. But I remember like there was another incarnation of that team. And like in the latter years, we played in LA Nipple, we ended up winning that. And like Brandon Lambertson was on the team.
Oh, wow.
That was pretty dope. Yeah. And then I remember right before I went out of the sport at that time, I was playing on Out of Control. So I did a tryout for Out of Control. They had me try out. My buddy Shane brought me up there. They had me try out in this like indoor place with sawdust on the ground and like plywood bunkers. I don't remember where this was, but I remember playing in this place. I'm like, wow, this is really small. I'm like, oh, look at all these plywood bunkers. I bet if I just ran through the middle of the field, I could probably shoot like two or three guys. And like, literally I did that like two, I'm like, just I'm just running through the middle of the field, just shooting a couple of guys like that twice. I'm like, I think I made the team.
There you go.
So we ended up going. Yeah. So Chris from Cap put that together. Mm. And it was Neil Everly.
One of my favorites. Dude. Love Neil.
So good. Yeah. Oliver, Ryan, my buddy Shane, myself, Witt.
Yeah.
Chris. And there was one, John, so a guy named John. And remember, we went to that Boston MPPL tournament, and it's interesting, right? So, you know, we have some games, we don't end up placing, but we come out of there and like everything, it had been like my dream up to that point to get paintball on somebody else's dime and to be able to play for free, essentially. And like, that was the first time in my entire life that I had achieved that goal. And so Chris covered everything. We went out there and played. We didn't win. I can't tell you why. We're with a star-studded
That lineup is, I mean, that's out of a story. You know what I'm saying? That's a storybook lineup right there.
Dude, it's crazy, right? And like to even have some cool games where like you're playing the All-Americans and you get to shoot three of them. You know, yeah. And you're just having these moments. I remember that was a game where like, these guys, like Oliver was in the middle and they kept coming for Oliver in this bunker, and I ended up shooting three guys out of this bunker because they just kept trying to come and get him every time. I'm like, well, we're going to keep walking up there. I'm going to keep shooting him. But it was weird. So, but what I came away from that event was number one, I had like immense pressure on myself, not from really any outside source, but on myself to figure out where I was going in my life, right? Like how was I going to pay for my future? I'm 22 years old. I'm working on my second AA degree in community college. I'm working at a camera shop, and I'm making minimum wage, and I can just barely afford to put one weekend in front of the next, right? And we have to win in order for me to do that. And I remember just coming out of that event and achieving what I wanted to like reach that level as far as like getting even started there. And for some reason, man, I just felt like hollow in a weird way. Like it didn't fill the void. And I think part of that is looking back on it is that I really wanted to do that with the crew of guys that I came up with. And instead, you know, like we didn't get to build that together. Instead, it was like sort of like we'd been assembled on this, you know, sort of roster. And I don't know. It was just interesting. Right. And from there.
I think what's most interesting is that you who most like prior to this conversation, Esh, I never knew that you were a part of a lineup like that, or like that's impressive. Not very many people in the world can say that they played on a line like that and even had the opportunity to study individuals of that caliber. What was, before you lead into that, I just want to, what was it like playing alongside young Oliver?
Yeah, well, I think this is right before he became legendary. Because this is the irony of it all, gents, is that I tell them, they go, I say, hey, I think I'm gonna go pursue art school because I've been going to junior college, and this on a turn of event, I just like become, I realized I had this uncanny ability for art. Like I could just draw. It's just innate within me. I didn't know that. I just discovered it while in junior college.
That's crazy.
Right? Like I was just like, wow. And then like, I remember like the instructor handing me charcoal and he's like, hey, do this portrait. I'm like, okay. And he gave me some like very basic ideas, like light, shadow, horizon line, vanishing points. I'm like, oh, and it was literally like someone just threw a switch in my brain. I'm like, oh, wow, that all kind of makes sense. Like, I wonder if I could do this. And I went home and I did a self-portrait, and I came back to class and he's like, I'm going to get you a scholarship to art school. It was like, I'd literally been like just screwing around, like getting an associate's arts degree, getting associate's science degree, just like passing the time while I was trying to pursue paintball. That's all I cared about. And then to have this like life-changing moment with art like that, it was interesting. So I have that burden on me when I'm playing that last game, but Oliver hadn't quite become Oliver at that point, right? He was good. All those, you know, all of them were amazing paintball players, and they were like, dude, we were to have like battles, right? It was like, you know, but he wasn't doing the run-throughs at that time. He wasn't doing that yet. He would survive. He would get in the thick of it, take bodies with him, close games. He was doing all that stuff. So I leave that event, and the very next event, I think they get the whole band and they go win World Cup. Mm. You know, isn't that weird?
Like, you're like, damn it, just missed it.
I stepped off the boat for the boat to go discover the new world.
Yeah, but
I can't, you know, so it's interesting to like have that path, that moment. And I look back at that moment and I'm like, wow, that's kind of crazy that was like my choice. It was right, you know, right there, go do this or go do that. And I went and did this. And I think at that point for me, it was the right choice.
Dude, but you're going to save paintball now. You're going to bring the hottest film to the game. It's the ripple effect. You were supposed to make that decision back then, dude. Otherwise, you would probably just still be one of the old heads on Dynasty, and me and Tyler would be fighting with you every weekend.
I don't know if it would have gone that far. I would have liked to think that it would have extrapolated out to that, but I don't know. You know, that was just one tournament in a long line, and a lot of things would have had to go right for any sort of thing like that to happen. But
of course,
amazing. But so anyways, I go up. Yeah, so like that was kind of the end of paintball, I think, for me at that moment, right? So in like that was like 2000, I think, right around that area, 2001. I go to art school on a scholarship. And instantly get into loggerheads with my professor, right? He wants, I'm like, I'm there. He's an abstract painter and I'm more of like a figurative painter. So I love like Degas, Edward Hopper, things like that. He's more into like ellipse with tract, which is like more abstract conceptual pieces. And I'm a schmuck, really opinionated 22-year-old at that time. And I don't know how to play the game. And I go to loggerheads with him, dude. I'm doing like cartoons, you know, sending them up in my studio and posting them on the walls and just doing really silly things, you know, like that. And I had an amazing time in art school and collaborating with the fellow artists there and like hanging out in studio. But ultimately at the end of that semester, even he came to me and he said, Eshram, you know, you don't belong here. You know, and he gave me a D, you know, in the class. And so I lost my scholarship. And I remember just talking to my brother on the phone one day, and it's interesting, like this is sort of that moment, right, where everything in your life sort of conspires to send you in a direction. So I'm at art school, I'm not having a great time, and I watched two movies. I watched The Barfly and I watched The Real Blonde. And I watched those movies, and these are independent movies, they're small, but I could for the first time see the craft in them and how they were made. And I was like, oh wow, like I could actually get my brother and like write lines for my friends and like go down and like shoot this scene in the local bar or something. And so I call my brother the next day, and he's in Bakersfield because my brother's like an amazing wrestler. So he's like top 16 in the country wrestler. And so I call him, I go, hey man, I go, you know, this art school thing may not be working out for me. I think I'm going to come back to California. And he's like, okay, well, I'm like writing plays and stuff. And I go, yeah, it's awesome. I'm gonna come back and like, I'll spend the summer there. And like, maybe I'll start playing paintball again. I don't know. Get a waiting job at some restaurant. Like, I don't know. And he goes, you know, I watched two movies last night. And I'm like, dude, I watched two movies last night. And he goes, and I'm like, they kind of affected me. He's like, dude, they affected me too. And I go, what is it? What did you watch? He goes, I watched The Barfly and I watched The Real Blonde.
No,
unbeknownst to each other. Dude, I'm in Kansas City, Missouri. He's in Bakersfield, California. We watched the same two movies on the same night, and the switch flipped for both of us. And I said, dude, I'm coming back this summer and we're gonna start writing scripts and we're gonna shoot some stuff. And he's like, awesome. So I came back that summer. My dad has like all this old like camera equipment and stuff in the garage. I gaffled that. I got my laptop out. We started shooting some really bad short films and putting them together and waking up all my friends in the neighborhood and like showing them videos while they're in their robes in the middle of the night. And if we were just hooked, man, honestly, it was like everything that we had done in our lives, right? So my dad's a photographer. I'd worked in his studio for 10 to 15 years. I was taking pictures, developing pictures. I learned composition, color, all that stuff in his studio and in his labs. Drawing, right? Like it just unspooled in front of me that I had this ability to draw. A love of movies. And now my brother is an English major who's studying plays and all this stuff. And it was like, it was on, man. We just saw the path so clearly that it was movies or bust. And so we got a flat together in Bakersfield, and that was all we did, man. We would watch movies every night. We doubled down, we tripled down. We started writing screenplays. We got a book on how to sell your screenplay in Hollywood. So we went and to write a query letter. And I remember this is just after 9/11 had happened. And so we wrote a really, and it said, make sure your query letter stands out. So Ian and I put some really offensive language in there, using a lot of F-bombs and things like that to sort of wake them up, right? To spark interest. Don't do that. Doesn't work. But we go down to LA, and it's like a week before Christmas. Nobody's there, dudes. And like, we're just walking into offices and slamming this query letter on, ambushing these poor people. And they're like, okay, great. Yeah. Thanks. You know, thanks a lot. And ultimately it ended up in a couple callbacks, but it was just enough to get us incentivized. And the very next year, my brother graduated, and then we moved to LA in 2002 and had no idea how to make movies, how to get into the business, anything other than just a desire to do it. Yeah. Wow. I mean, I can keep going if you want to know that.
So,
one.
Yeah. So what have you learned? What have you learned in the 20 years being there?
So, you know what? Honestly, like if I could just distill it down to one thing, right? It's just make stuff.
Yeah.
That's it. It's so simple. Like make stuff, right? So I remember we got to LA and I got a job at an iconic movie theater, Arclight Hollywood. Cinerama Dome.
Damn.
And it was a minimum job, but I got free movies, and I was around a bunch of cinephiles like myself that just love movies. But first my brother and I were going to go to film school, right? So we went to USC film school, and they were like, if you love Star Wars, come on in. This is for you, you know, Lucas, you know, safe haven. And then I went over to USC, and they're like, if your favorite movie is Star Wars, get the fuck out of here. This is for real artists. And then we went over to LA Film Academy, and they're like, on the sixth year, like, you'll get to touch a camera. And I'm like, that's not going to work. Like, I want to start making stuff right now. So I'm driving my beloved 84 van again around LA, schlepping back and forth to work, and I get rear-ended. And fortunately, I'm mechanically inclined. So I decide that I'm going to take that $1,600 windfall from the auto insurance policy, and we're going to go out, we're going to buy a DVX100 camera, which is like the latest innovation in prosumer video products. And so my brother and I, we bought that camera, and we just started shooting everything in sight. And honestly, like, I remember, like, we had to learn Final Cut Pro, and there was like a manual that was like as thick as a telephone book. So I dove into that 600 page manual, and then my brother's like, okay, what'd you learn? Tell me.
So, jeez.
Yeah, it was crazy, man. And I just remember, like, we're coming back to work, and like, we shot a full-length feature film, the one I was talking about, for $1,500. And we were working with people that had gone to USC, and they're like, you guys just went out and shot a film? Like, how'd you do that? And I was like, well, we just did it. Like, I don't know. Like, my dad did the lighting and they're like, we want to do that. So we rounded up like five of our most talented friends, right? The friends that we really got along with, and we went out. And we got into one film festival with that first film. And it was just so amazing to sit there and project your film in front of an audience, have them respond to it somewhat appropriately, laugh in the right spots, you know, maybe some other things. But to sit there and share that communal experience with people, man, it was honestly like a drug you could not get enough of. It was just like, okay, like, this is what I want to do for the rest of my life. This absolutely makes sense. And so Ian and I were hooked. We came back and we're like, let's make another one. And this time we'll really go wild and we'll spend $5,000. And so we got four other filmmakers, and we all made a collaborative movie where you're each going to write, direct, and star in a section of it. And that's Night of the Dog. I sent that to you guys. And it all had to start and end at the same place. And that was really the only parameters. And it all had to take place in one night. And so we went and we shot this guerrilla style on the streets of LA. And it was a wonderful experience, honestly. Like, we went back after that movie and ended up winning all the film festivals that we had just barely eked into the previous year.
Wow.
And like, Focus called, like Miramax called, like, we got managers. It was crazy.
That is unbelievable. You, my friend, are the definition of a closer. You just never stop. You're relentless. You're just pushing and pushing and pushing until you get there, and then you just keep going again and again and again, and you never stop. And that is such a key component that I think so many people can find value in anything that you do, right?
Yeah, that's it, right? I mean, have you guys read Tim Grover's book?
Cleaner.
Yeah.
Cleaner, I was just going to say.
Cleaner, yeah, sorry.
That's right. Yeah, man, that book really, really was eye-opening.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Sorry, no, I said closer, cleaner. That you're a cleaner, man. You just push it to the limits, dude. That's amazing.
Yeah, closer too. You know, they go hand in hand.
I think you got to beat all of them at one point or another, right?
Yeah, exactly.
There's different roles you need to fill at different times. And you just got to know what role you need to do when. That's really all there is to it.
Mm-hmm. If you want to succeed Timing. At something, you have to be relentless in the pursuit as well. You can't deter because of a few no's or lose your inspiration because of any outside noise. Like if you find conviction within yourself to do something, you just got to go all in on it. That's the only way to succeed because other people are willing to do that for what you want. So mm-hmm. if you want it, you know, you have to want it more than them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, you're absolutely right, brother. No, and you guys are doing that, right? Like,
yeah.
You guys push are pouring it. It all in.
Yeah, push to the limits.
Push it to the limit.
Yeah.
Right, how much more you guys got in the tank? You want to keep going? I don't know. You tell me.
This is amazing. Yeah, you're crushing it.
Great storyteller. Go figure.
If you guys get bored, though, just let me know. I can wrap it up.
No. I definitely still have a few questions. You know, again, I want to kind of tie it back in. And I mean, dude, I had no clue your history in the game. That's really fascinating. It's a huge surprise to hear you played with, you know, the young legends, Oliver, mm-hmm. Alex, those guys up at their field. That's really cool, actually.
It's spectacular.
It is. That's a neat nugget. I'm sure all the listeners that, you know, have listened to all the shows too are going to, like, it's a cool full circle kind of thing.
Oh, they're going to go watch all these films that we just named.
Dude, they
off,
have to.
You know?
Yeah, they have to. I want to get watching some of them as well.
You want me to take you through how I got to those, or what do you guys want?
Do what?
Yeah, definitely.
Try to get you the fast track to those movies.
Okay.
I do want to hear your lineage and like get us up to present moment, and then we'll ask a couple questions here.
I'll try to do it quick, guys. I'm sorry.
No, don't apologize, man. This is what the show's about.
So in 05, we get indicted dog, and we get managers, we get representation, and the first thing they tell us is, okay, stop wasting your time making these shitty little movies. The next movie you make is going to be $8 million. Perfect. Sheesh. Sounds good, right? Like, I want that ticket. Let's go. Cut to 6 years later. No movies have happened. But my brother and I have written like a catalog of scripts, and none of them have been produced. And it's 6 years later, and we're so frustrated at this point, because our career has literally just stagnated, right? We've been out, we've been making short films and stuff like that, but no one, we would go into meetings, right? And Fat Man was in those scripts. 12-year-old boy hires a hitman to kill Santa Claus was in those scripts. Small Town Crime was in those scripts. And we would go in those meetings and people go, wow, we like these scripts. We dig this. Someone should make them. I'm like, it's us. Like, we're going to make them, right? And they're like, no. These are execution dependent. So, you know, you get a director in here, you know, you don't really know how that's going to, you know, it's like, how is this going to look? I'm like, what's on the page? I'm like, oh, no. Every director has a different interpretation of how this material is going to be. So, you know, and Ian and I got offers, man. Like, they would say, hey, we're going to buy this script off of you. And we're like, like, we're not going to sell that. We're going to make that one. Mm-hmm. And so cut to 6 years later, we're going to stick to our guns because we're like used to being poor. Right? Like, I can make $50 go a long way at Ralph's. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So we're sitting there and we get to 6 years later, and my brother and I have endeavored into other businesses, right? So we became swimming teachers in LA. So we're teaching 2 and 3 year olds how to swim. We're doing private lessons all throughout LA. And so that job afforded us to be picky. We didn't have to compromise because we weren't going to starve to death. We could always get by with this. Mm-hmm. And so we go and we finally get to a point where we're so fed up. And we say, okay, you know what? We're going to go out. We're going to make another movie. And no matter what we have, we're going to make it for that. And my brother had scrimped and saved over the preceding 6 years, and it had $50,000 in his bank account. And it's like, we're going to go out and we're going to make Lost on Purpose, which is a love letter to our hometown. We grew up in Central Valley. And it's like, we're gonna try to capture that zeitgeist and that era for us. And so we went out there with 50 grand and we started fundraising money. And people would be like, hey, you know, like, we're like, hey, we're trying to raise money. And they're like, you have any other backers? We go, absolutely. Got 50 grand in backing already. Mm-hmm. And because it was our money, we're putting our money into it. Like, oh, okay, great. Like, I'll give you another 10. I'll give you this. So eventually we end up building that up to like 190 grand. And so we go out to the Central Valley and we end up shooting that movie for 190 grand. And it was like our first movie with a full size crew and budget. And we had like Jane Kaczmarek and C. Thomas Howell and James Lafferty, a bunch of these actors that were names for the first time in our lives. And we ended up meeting our cinematographer, Johnny Durango, who shot like our last four movies with us. And like all these amazing relationships happened because of that movie. And so we get back and we have that movie, right? We put our money. I remember at one point during the production, my brother comes up to me and we were like on day like 25 of 33. And my brother's Ian, and he goes, you know, Esh, it's not going to be today. It's probably not going to be tomorrow, but at some point we're going to run out of money. And I'm like, what? And he goes, yeah, dude, we're a little under, but we got our credit cards. We can like put it on the credit cards.
Oh no.
I'm like, oh, okay. Like, and I'm like, how much do we have on credit cards? He goes, about 10,000 we can put on the credit cards. I'm like, okay, but that still doesn't get us to the end of the movie. He goes, nope, it does not. So lo and behold, dude, the community of Visalia throws a fundraiser to raise us another 25 grand and gets investors to put in the movies so we can finish the picture.
Whoa.
It's just like,
yes.
But it's for anything, right, guys? Like, if you are willing to lay it all on the line and put everything you have into an endeavor, and people can feel that, they can sense that, they know that you're not BSing them in any way, if this is all you have and it's right here on the line, like, the world will conspire with you.
Dude,
that's powerful. That's powerful stuff.
Dude, so yeah. We get that one done, right? So we get the spot, we get Lost on Purpose done. It goes out in the festival world, and all of a sudden people are coming to us and they're like, we had that movie budgeted by a professional LA line producer, and he told us it was gonna be $8 million to make that movie. We made it for 250 grand. So lo and behold, like, people were like freaking out, right? Like, how did you do that? We had another producer come to us, Autumn McGallopin, and she's like, I just watched your movie in a film festival. The film festival guy was raving about it. And he says, I have to talk to you about getting my script made. And this was a movie we did called Waffle Street. And she's like, it's based on a memoir. Here's the script. It's been did development all over town. No one, you know, the script is written to be like $20 million, but we only have 500,000. You and your brother want to read it, right? And so Ian and I are like, okay, well, we'll read it. So we go, we read it. And we spent a lot of time behind the scenes at restaurants, had a lot of server PTSD. And this movie's all about a guy, you know, $8 billion hedge fund manager who gets sacked for nefarious trading and then ends up redeeming his soul at a Waffle House, you know, while slinging hash and pancakes with Danny Glover, you know? And so that was sort of the movie. And so she gives us the script and we read it and we go, yep, this is a $20 million script. And she's like, yeah, you know, I want to shoot it in Utah for $500,000. And Ian and I look at each other. We go, give us the book because it's based on a memoir. So we read the book and we come back to her and we go, okay, if we shoot the book, we can do this. Are you open to us adjusting the script? And if we do, we'll do it for free, but you have to promise us you'll make the movie. And so we handshake on it right then and there. My brother and I go out. We rewrite the script in a month. We go back to her and she's like, we're greenlit in 2 months. We're in Utah in 2 more months shooting the movie with Danny Glover. You know, amazing experience all around, right? You're just like, this does not happen. Like, you're just like, bang, bang, bang. So we go from having a barren wasteland of 6 years with nothing to having two back-to-back movies, literally almost shooting in consecutive like years. And so then we get done with the movie and we show it to our managers. Right. And they watch it and they get back to us and they go, we don't see how this movie leads to the crime thrillers that you guys have been writing. And we're like, well, yeah, I get it. But, you know, did you like the movie? Yeah, you know, we like the movie. Well, you know, it's on Netflix. It's doing well, you know. And they're like, yeah, we don't see how this leads to the crime thrillers. We're going to let you guys go. They cut my brother and I off. We lost our manager and our agent. They fired us. We're like, see you later.
What? No way.
They literally told us, they go, we don't see how this leads to the crime thrillers. And Ian and I were like, look, we found a way into the movie that excited us. Yeah. I can't tell you how this is going to pay back, but it will. I can't explain, right? I don't understand how sort of a, you know, what Ian and I call our clean routine movie, right? So we made Lost on purpose and we showed it to our dad and he watches it and he goes, I liked it, boys. Can you use any other word than fuck? And I'm like, let me see, right? And so Waffle Street came along and we're like, dude, we could do our clean routine movie. Like this could be, you know, a movie that dad could get behind. And so we go out, we made it. And then so anyways, they sack us, right? What do you think happens next?
Sheesh.
It gets on, right? You can't tell. Who knows, right? It's crazy. It gets on Waffle. It gets on Netflix. This is when Netflix has no content, but an incredibly high viewership, right? Mm-hmm. So you go on there and you're watching anything because you have this membership and it's free and it's just bombarding at you. Dude, Waffle Street ends up getting like 250,000 reviews on Netflix, which is insanity considering like not everybody's reviewing that movie. My girlfriend and I would take trips up to Portland and we'd be at bars and they're talking to the bartender. Da, da, da. He's like, what do you do? Oh, I'm a filmmaker. Make anything I've seen. I don't know. I made like a small movie that's on Netflix called Waffle Street. My wife and I love that movie. Like the reach funny. Of that movie was insane. Yeah. And so the producers, they come back to us and they're like, hey, what are you guys doing? And we're like, I don't know. Like we just got fired. I don't know. Or, you know, I guess we're back to schlepping, you know, doing swimming lessons or whatever it's going to be. And he goes, I got it. The producers of Waffle Street. They go, we have an investor has $2.5 million. You think you got something for that? You know, like reaching for the catalog. Come up, we go, well, we've got these crime thrillers, but they're nothing like Waffle Street. And he goes, well, let us read one. And we go, yeah, great. We hand it to him. He comes back like the next night. He's like, I love this. This is great. Let's make it. We just need a cast. It's like, okay, great. He goes, you just get a cast that makes, you know, warrants $2.5 million and we'll make this for you guys. Well, there's the rub, right? So Ian and I are like, well, who do we know? Well, it just so happens when we first moved to LA, we were introduced to a lovely woman named Octavia Spencer of The Help, right? And so she was one of our friends. And I remember going to her and saying, we went over there for an evening, we're hanging out. She's like, what are you guys doing? And we had just finished the trailer for Waffle Street. We show her the Waffle Street trailer. She's like, this is amazing, you know? What are you guys doing next? And we're like, well, we're doing this crime thriller. And we hand her the script for Small Town Crime. And she's going, we knew she had a soft spot for crime thrillers, right? Because she would like sit there and watch like Making of a Murderer and be like, oh, he did it, y'all. I feel it. I know he did it. You know, so we're like, oh, shoot. Like we're crossing our fingers, our toes. We're showing her storyboards, putting that drawing talent to use, whatever I can do. Mm-hmm. And we cross our fingers, we go home. She calls us 12 hours later. She's like, I'm in. I'm EPing it. Bring your list, boys. Who do you want to act in these roles? So we like come over there. We start building out that cast. We get like Anthony Anderson, John Hawks, like amazing actors come back to the producers. They're like, yep, green light. Off to Utah to shoot that. And so we go off to Utah, shoot that movie, come back, and we get turned down from every festival, right? Because we showed the cut a little too early. So when you're editing the movie, you've got to get that movie dialed because you only get one shot with anybody, right? So you got to get that movie dialed. And so when you're showing, you know, you're hurrying to make these festival deadlines, you might jam it a little bit. It's not quite there, but you're like, maybe it's good enough. Well, it wasn't good enough. And everybody was worried. And finally we get into South by Southwest with the final cut that we all liked. And dude, honestly, like everything's hanging on this South by Southwest screening, right? Because you got a $2.5 million movie that needs to recoup, or you pretty much don't, you know, you're spending that much money, everything's on the line, right? And I remember the film director comes out, Janet, she's amazing, love her. But she says, I just want to put, you know, she's talking to all the filmmakers that have been curated. Just want to put this in perspective for you guys. Like, this isn't Sundance. This isn't Toronto. Like, you're not, $1 million sales don't happen here. You're not going to sell your movie for millions of dollars. What this festival is about is connections. Well, my brother and I turned to each other and we're like, we're going to sell our movie for $2 million. We're going to sell this. We're going to make the biggest sale this festival has ever had, right? Like, that's, please tell me I can't do something, because that's like, it lights a fuse in me. And so we, you know, that's our mentality, right? Like, we have to do this. So we go back, and fortunately, like I said, my girlfriend's a publicist, and she navigates this perfectly for us. She helps us do all the things. We get all the cast out there. We have this amazing screening. Because of the hype we were getting on the movie, they elevated us to like one of the premiere screenings. So we get to show in like the biggest 1,700 seat theater in the of the festival. Talk about pressure, gents. Like, we're sitting there and we're having our premiere, and Ian and I are sitting in the balcony, and I can't sit in the crowd. Like, I have to sit at in the wings, right? But I can't not watch. I have to see if the reactions are hitting. And we're sitting up there just, you know, nervous as all can be. And honestly, dudes, like, it was one of the most highlight audience reactions ever. Of anything I might ever do. I don't. But it got, like, people were cheering at the shootouts. People were laughing at all the jokes. And when it was over, they gave us a standing ovation. It was insanity. It's utter insanity. Yeah. I mean, just telling that story now makes the hair on my arm stand up. And instantly we go to the after party, and people are running up and they're like, we just got an offer on the movie. We just got an offer on the movie. Long story short, it ends up selling for like $2.5 million, and everybody makes their money. And Ian and I get to go make another one. And right. It's like, and we get representation, we get new reps. We get a rebirth, so to speak. And so we get new reps, and the next in the queue is Fat Man. And it's an interesting script and story in that, look, a 12-year-old boy that hires a hitman to kill Santa Claus after receiving a lump of his colon sucking, that gets you a lot of meetings, right? But half of those meetings are, they just want to see the crazy people that are going to walk through the door. Like, what do these maniacs look like, right? And finally, I remember, like, we went to a screening of Hacksaw Ridge with Gibson in like 2016. And he's sitting there, and he's got this big, feral, bushy beard, and he's like kneading it, you know, and he looks like the weight of the world is on his shoulders, and he's like telling all these war stories from the movie and all this good stuff. And Ian and I look at each other and go, gosh, that guy looks like he's been ravaged by the world. He's carrying the weight of the world on his shoulders, but he's still got that sparkle, that passion in the eyes. And go, that's our Chris. I feel like that's Chris. And so we go back, we pitch our managers and agents this, and they're like, well, good luck with that one. And so we go, no, we want to do that. We want to go to Gibson. So we go to Gibson, and Ian and I are sitting here, and we're fielding meetings from producers and all this stuff. And we get this email, right? Like, randomly. And it's like, hey, and we've been getting a bunch of emails like, oh, hey, let's meet, let's do this, whatever. He says, hey, I did the script. You know, let's sit down for a chin wag. It's like, a chin wag? What the, like, who is, the, you know, and my brother's like, what the heck is this? Who is this? And he goes, hey, yeah, glad you like the script, like, let's sit down, man. Who is this? And he goes, oh, and mind you, the email isn't like, you know, Braveheart dude 25, right? It's like cryptic, you could never know who it is, right? And so it's like, oh, this is Mel. Sometimes I forget to sign off. Dude, I can't even begin. My brother and I hugged. There might've been tears. we're like Mel's in, he likes the script. So we call the agent, and they're like, well, we don't know if Mel likes the script yet. He wants to sit down with you guys. Like, can you go meet him up for a coffee shop? You got like 45 minutes to pitch him your take and see if he likes it. I'm like, oh god, okay, pressure's on, huh? You know, like, we're stretching out. We go up there, we're sitting in the coffee shop. Ian and I get there early. We have a couple of Danishes, we get caffeinated, we're ready to roll, and in walks Gibson with his protein shake and shorts. You know, the guy's probably just did a jog on the beach. And he's like, oh, hey, what's up, guys? And we sit there, and we proceed to have a 3.5-hour conversation with Mel about everything, man, about movies, about life, about our movie. You know, it ran.
Did you talk to him about paintball? Did you tell him about paintball? Yeah.
I know I've mentioned paintball to Mel, and I got
to
get it.
We need to do a Braveheart reenactment with paintball. Like, come on, this is a missed opportunity. You should be thinking of these things.
No, I pitch everyone paintball. Every single human I've met, I pitched in paintball. I've gotten my manager to play. I've got a few. I'm working on. You know, I'm working on some.
Esham, I real quick, about 20 minutes ago, I wanted to kind of highlight something you said, but it was too valuable. I couldn't interrupt.
Oh, sorry, dude.
No, dude. Honestly, that it is so valuable. But you said it was 6 years of a barren wasteland, and it wasn't. That whole 6 years, you were nourishing your and watering, you were planting seeds and you were watering everything that you were growing, and nothing had sprouted yet, but it was not a wasteland. It was something that you were putting so much time and effort into, and it was just taking a long time to sprout, right? And you see that so frequently with people when they are pursuing something. They put all this time and effort in over and over and over, and they get told no, and they get told no, and they get told no, and then they just quit. And usually that's the tipping point. Right before they're about to, you know, succeed in what they're doing, they give up on it. Whereas if you just like, clearly, like, that's what you did. That's what you and your brother did. You guys just kept going and kept working and kept going and kept believing in yourself and what you guys were doing. And next thing you know, you're sitting in a coffee shop with Mel Gibson for 3.5 hours talking about another movie you're going to be making, right?
Like, dude, and that's it, right? And I'm so grateful for my brother and the collaboration that we have, much like I imagine your relationship is, right? Because there's days where you aren't feeling it. Right? Where maybe your head's hanging a little low, where you need that kick in the fanny to say, hey, let's go, man. We're right there. We're on the finish line. Or you know what? And like, he and I end up playing that role for each other quite often. It's like, oh, dude, you know what? Like, you need to get your blood up. Let's go right now.
Yeah.
Let's charge it. And if there's one thing I could tell people, it's like, get a collaborator.
Yeah.
Someone that pushes you, that charges you, that respects your perspective as much as you respect theirs. And that relationship will flourish.
Absolutely. Yeah. That's brilliant, man. I love it.
This is great. But anyway, so we sit there in that coffee shop for 3.5 hours, dude. And he's like, oh, boys, yeah, let's do this. And that's it. And it's like, that is it. It's just like, bang, after 3.5 hour conversation, he's like, oh, yeah, you know, like, let's just do this. I like this. And off we are. Then we're into Utah shooting a movie in negative 30 degrees. It's a whole thing in itself.
Yeah. Talk to us about that experience of shooting that one. For everybody, we're talking about Fat Man, so go check it out. It's on Netflix. You can watch it right now.
It's on Peacock.
Oh, and Peacock.
Well, so it didn't. It's not on Netflix. It's on Amazon Prime. And
okay,
you can purchase it through Amazon, or if you have Peacock, you can stream it for free on there. And then Small Town Crime is on Netflix. So you can. That just got put back on their service. Awesome. Dude, so okay, yeah, so now it's off to Utah, right? Oh, I'm sorry, Canada. And we shot in Ottawa, Canada, mm-hmm. which is north of Toronto. And boys, it gets cold up there. I can't even begin to tell you this. Like, Ian and I are California kids. We grew up in the Central California, but I've been real softened by this SoCal weather. And I'm going to tell you, like, I'll just give a little anecdote to kind of put it in perspective. So Ian and I are up there. We're shooting there's like a shootout scene in the movie, and Mel Gibson's facing off against Walton in the climactic, you know, moment. And I'm not kidding you. It's negative 36 degrees, negative 36 degrees. And Ian and I, and at one point I'm going through storyboards. I'm showing the art department. I'm like, hey, we're going to go here. And I'm showing the stunt department. He's going to go here. And the gaffer, the grip, and he, you know, walks up to me and he goes, Esh, I've had it on my radar, and you've had your gloves off for 6 minutes now. Can you feel your fingers? I go, dude, I lost feeling in my fingers 5 minutes ago. He goes, just so you know, at 8 minutes, it's irreparable frostbite. So you might want to put some hand warmers on and put those gloves back in the mittens. And I'm like, good note. Good note, sir. Thank you. And so Ian and I are out there, dude. We're shooting this movie. It's negative 36. It's 1 degree from when they shut down production. So at negative 37, it's a no-go, but at negative 36, green light. And so we're sitting there, and Ian and I are dressed like we're going to summit Everest. The only thing we're missing are oxygen containers. We're in like the full down hoodies, parkas, mittens, everything. Mel Gibson is in his costume and some like thermals, right? He's sitting there. He just soldiers through all of this, right? We finish his coverage. We're like, hey, Mel, you can head on back to the trailer, dude. You're done. Like, go warm up. He goes, oh, no. You guys are in this? I'm in this. He stood out there the whole 14-hour day with us in his costume, which had fingerless gloves because he's doing gunplay, and sipping a green tea and just regaling all this, like all the crew members, telling stories from Braveheart, all that stuff. I remember he was telling us, he's like, I remember in Braveheart, like I double printed a frame And I'm like, you double printed a frame? He's like, yeah, I did like a double print frame for emphasis on one of the stab wounds. And we're like, double printing a frame. And I double printed a frame. Like, I'm taking every.
What does that mean to double print a frame?
Oh, so every second of a movie has 24 frames in it. And okay. So when you take one of those frames and you repeat it, it's the same image just for a
Gotcha.
1/12 of a second. Just hangs a little bit longer, and you're like, that stood out. It pops, right? So right when there's a moment in our movie where a blade is run through somebody, it lingers a second longer for emphasis, right? It was just really interesting to work with Mel, man, because he's been on both sides of the camera, right? Like, the dude's an Oscar-winning director.
Yeah.
What am I, you know, Ian and I are like, what are we going to tell this guy? Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, but at the same point, you're just like, we're just going to lead with the movie we want to make and hope for the best and see how that goes. And honestly, like, he's one of the top collaborators I've ever worked with. Like, the dude is in it to win it. He's like, because I think he's worked on both sides of the camera, he knows exactly the environment to be created so that gets the best results, right? Sure. Like, you got it on a film set, like, there can be no hypocrisy, right? Like, you can't sit there and say, oh, hey, I need the whole crew to sit out here in the cold. I'll be in the warming tent having a latte. Call me when it's ready. That's not how it works. That crap doesn't fly. You got to be out there. If they're out there in the weather, you're out there in the weather. If you're asking them to do long, protracted days, you're doing protracted days. Like one thing I'll tell you about movie making is like, dude, yes, man. It's a top down thing, right? Like, you can't sit there and be hypocritical in any way. Like, on a movie set, it's about a 4-month process, and we get to sleep for 3 hours a night for 3 months.
Brutal.
Dude, you are demolished at the end of that, man. That's no joke. Like, that's not an exaggeration. On Saturday, Sunday, you might get to catch up with 6 or 7 hours, but Monday through Friday, it's 3 hours. And I get up 5 hours before call to do the storyboards. So I land hot on that set, and my brother and I know exactly what we're doing, and we can sit there and communicate to our camera teams, our art department, all that stuff. And it's honestly, man, you get rode hard and put away wet. It's not an easy gig.
And when you love what you're doing, it kind of, you know,
softens the blow.
Right. It doesn't even feel like work. Mm-hmm. It's crazy because I was doing it for free, and now I get paid to do it. It's amazing.
Dude. Yeah. I can't say enough good things about these stories. This is a mind blower. This is crazy.
Absolutely.
Oh man, these stories are unreal.
And so I don't know if you guys, so I use all of that paintball knowledge to block the gunfights. So if you look at the gunfight in Small Town Crime and the gunfight in Fat Man, there's literally I take all of my perspective from paintball and put them in there. And it's not 100% paintball because bullets rip through cars and things like that. But my brother Ian's always like, oh, I should stage another paintball game.
Tight.
That's awesome.
I can't wait to
see it. I can't wait to, I'm going to dive into all the movies that you've made and watch them from start to finish, from the shorts to the features, and really dive into all this. And it's just crazy what you've done, Esham. And man, what a blessing to the film industry and the paintball world you are for us all to be able to pick your brain and have fun telling these stories, man.
Hey guys, look, we're just getting started. So thank you so much for this time and sharing it with me. And I want to work with you guys, man. I want to help you transcend the game. You know, like, let's collaborate on some stuff. Let's make it
absolutely
happen.
Well, we definitely have some questions. I know Marsh has a couple more questions. We're coming up on, you know, quite a bit of time that we've sat with you, and we're so appreciative of every second. And we just want to make sure that you guys all know out there who are tuning in, you know, how special this is as well, because this guy's the real deal. And he has, from what you've said as well, even just in regards to paintball, some spectacular ideas on how we can further this amazing sport and get it in the optics of the masses. So that's the goal.
Honestly, thank you, but look, I'm just like you guys, right? Like, it's just hard work, man. It's all it is. It's 10,000 hours. It's just sit there and grind away, and you'll get where you want to go. It's that simple. And like, I got the formula. I got the board on my wall. You know, it's got my weekly goals, my monthly goals, and my long-term goals on there. And that reminds me every day what I need to be working towards, right?
Yeah. Yep. I got my post-its and stickies and crazy stuff everywhere, just always knocking at my brain, just reminding me where we're headed.
Dude, and inspiration's fleeting, man. The best thing you can do is carry a journal. Yeah. Absolutely, 1,000% carry that journal in your hip pocket every day and jot down those ideas or use your notes in your phone. But I find something amazing about the tactile of the journal, writing. You know?
Absolutely. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Physically writing something down is so much more. It just resonates a lot more with me. I think a lot of people as well, something about the brain definitely processes it a little more real.
Yeah, dude, you're so right. Like, I hate going to, it's such a bad habit, but like, I like to go to bed with, like, I'll read an actual paper book before I go to bed, right?
I'm not reading no Kindle.
No.
I can't do it.
Yeah.
I can't do it. Yeah.
Before we get off the Gibson topic, give us give us a couple of cool things about shooting with him. And I just think he's such a, like, a true character in the world, you know, in the world's optics, and just to have some insight on how amazing he is.
The dude's a legend, man. Yeah. A legend. And like, all right, let me just think this up. Okay, so there's one moment where we're sitting there and we're shooting a scene. This is an early on in the shooting process. And Mel shows up and he's like, hey, he walks up to my brother and I, he goes, what lens is on that camera back there? And I'm like, oh, I don't know. I think it's a long lens. You know, it's like a 70 or a 65. I can't tell you for sure. Okay, all right. What lens is on that camera over there? It points to another one. And I'm like, I think, oh, that's our normal lens. That's going to be like about a 50, something like that. Okay, all right, good. Walks off, right? And then we can shoot the scene. Next set comes up and he goes, what lens is that on that camera back there? And I'm like, that's 25, no? What's that one? That one's a 78, right? So he asked me this two or three times. I go back to Ian. I go, hey, Mel's asking me the lenses on every camera. I don't know what lenses are on. I don't know what lenses are on the camera, right? And I go back to Johnny, our DP. I'm like, hey, Johnny, what is this? What is that? And I said, I go to my brother. He wants us to know what lens is on every camera all the time. And if you think about it, that makes perfect sense, right? Because, right? Like, I draw the storyboard. And I'm like, oh, hey, make it look like this composition, right? That's I don't worry about what lens our DP Johnny puts on the camera. But Mel wants to know because he understands what the focal depth's going to be. He understands if you're in a tight close, you do less. If you're in a wide and you're way back there in the corner, you do a little bit more. Not a lot, a little bit more. He needs to know that nuance because he's plotting his performance for the cameras.
Wow.
Isn't that
detail? Details.
Yes. There was another moment where the sound guy solicited us for a take of just an actor audio. And Mel was like, okay, we're going to do this whole scene. What are we going to do here? He goes, Oh, yeah. And I said, hey, yeah, we're going to do the whole scene. He goes, okay, are we going to shoot camera B and camera A at the same time? Because we always shoot with two cameras. You want to get multiple angles so you can cut and if you shoot the two cameras at the same time, it can expedite your filming process so you get through more in a day. Mm. And only thing is, you have the sound guy running around. So he's like putting his boom pole in the shots and stuff. So he's going to try to get close for an actor's line. He's ruining your second camera shot. And so long story short, we're sitting there and we're shooting the scene and the boom pole comes in and it dips in and he gets the line, he backs out and Mel comes up to me, he goes, hey, Ash. He goes, I understand why you did it for the sound, but he's like, understand that you guys can pick that line up in a booth back in LA and you can only shoot this here in Canada. He's like, so I would be shooting every single moment I can of visuals because, you know, sound is very important. It really is. And Ian and I try to make a point of never looping any lines in our movie unless we absolutely have to, because that, like, naturalistic performance that happens on the day is paramount. You can't, it's hard to recreate that in the booth. So at some point it's true, but sometimes it's not. But he was just, you know, his point was made, right? It's like, you can do that in a booth. Sonic can be happening in the booth back in LA. Picture has to happen here. So, dude, there's some crazy stuff. I'll give one more. So we're driving through Canada, right? And we're with our location scout. And so, this isn't a Mel story. This is just the universe conspiring weird, raise your hair on your arm story. So we're driving through Canada and the location scout is navigating through Google Maps. And so we're literally like looking at farms and we have a very specific farm layout that's needed for the picture. It has to have a homestead. That's what it's called. So we call it the homestead in the script. And it has to have a barn, an auxiliary structure, and a main house, and then a gap in between those so we can have the firefight space in between there. The way just that it maps out in the picture. So we're driving around and we drove around Canada for 5 days. And I must have looked at 170 farms. My brother and I looked at 170 farms. We were so bleary-eyed. And I just remember we're at Google Maps and we're zooming in on what we think might look like the place from a topographical point of view. I remember we see one and we're like, oh, well, there's one right there. I'm like, but it's in the middle of a neighborhood, you know? And like, but there kind of looks like there's some trees. What is that? Well, let's just go look at it. Screw it. This is on the fifth day, right? We hadn't found anything that worked after scouting 170 farms all over, covering hundreds of miles in Canada. And if you get so far out from your production and you can't find location, it no longer makes sense. And we drive up the road and we turn left and the street is Homestead Road. Oh. Right? You're like, no, that's just too weird. So we're driving, we're passing above ground swimming pools because it's summer when we scouted this, trampolines, riding lawnmowers. And then we get up and we make a right and we go through this perfect tree line of pines, which opens up into the most picturesque, beautiful location on the freaking planet on Homestead Boulevard on that last day, right? When we were like, maybe we'll have to build something. And when Mel showed up for that set, I remember he walks on the set and he goes, my God, you guys built all this? And I was like, Mel, we didn't build anything. This is all here. And he's like, are you kidding me? It was incredible.
Just fate, man, dude. Just it was supposed to be.
You can't fight that. You just got to get on the right train and go.
That's amazing.
That's life right there. Yeah, that's amazing. Yeah, it's pretty cool what you've created, brother. It's really, and it's just like manifestation. You are attracting that into your experience and you're drawing these things in. And I'm sure that plays a part in your success as well.
I don't know, man. I just lead with my passions and let the rest sort itself out. You know, and I just try to be authentic and I try to treat people how I want to be treated. That's it. Mm-hmm. There's nothing, simple. It's no more complicated than that.
Yeah, that's cut and dry right there. I love that. Well, Marsh, let's dig into a couple questions.
Indeed.
And then I think we can round this thing out, man. What a spectacular story this has been. Just absolutely phenomenal. Crazy.
Esham, I have a question that is pretty similar to one of our listeners, Derek. His question is, what can the community do to make a paintball feature film a reality? Mine is more along the lines of what can we do from this moment forward to get paintball noticed by, you know, maybe Hollywood or other people that would want to showcase our sport.
Well, I would say number one is that we can't wait for them. We can't be dependent on someone else to give you the shine that you want. You got to go out and do that. And I'm telling you right now, the iPhones stuff in your pockets right now can capture gorgeous imagery. You're not limited by the device. All of our computers, our friggin' iPads can edit video now. What are we talking about? There's no excuses, right? We just need to go out and do it. And so look, I can't tell you that Hollywood's going to be clamoring, you know, with Channing Tatum lining up to do the paintball movie. I can't count on that. I'm not going to count on that. But what I can count on is that I can set a goal for myself. And no matter what, I can go out and realize a version of that film, right? Because I can call on all the favors within our community. Hey, Glenn, can I use your field? Hey, you know, like our first movie, like I said, was made in our hometown of Visalia. And people were so gracious to invite us into their homes and let us use their properties and make that happen. The world will conspire with you if you go out with the intent and the desire to do it. They'll see that.
It's all intention.
I don't know if that answered the question. I don't know if that answered it.
It does. No, it absolutely does. And it's actually something we talk about a lot too, is especially the pro players. Our device, our phone is so important. Our social media, we just putting out content on our own. We may not be be big film directors or anything like that, or have fancy editing skills and all that, but we can put out content. We can put out a ton of valuable content, quality, you know? And yeah.
Look, I watch Matty Boy stuff.
Totally.
You know, like, and get inspired from that. I'm like, oh, that's a good idea. You know, like, there's a lot of stuff out there. There's inspiration everywhere. Like, part of the reason for me to do the short form stuff is because I want to push myself in that realm. That's something I haven't done before. Mm-hmm. So it's like, oh, there is no hierarchy. What's better or worse? It's all feeding one common goal, which is to get better, right? Like, I know what I do in the short form stuff is going to translate to my feature length work.
Totally.
Yeah. It all correlates. Absolutely. Awesome. It's amazing. And then in regards, I have a question from Steve. He was wondering, how can Go Sports, you know, do their best moving forward with, you know, obviously keeping a budget in mind, to go from more of the short style to, you know, the features and doing more of that kind of stuff?
I think, look, the movies that I gravitated towards, are like Patrick Swayze movies, you know, like Heroes for a Day, like, you know, Sunday Drivers. Those are the movies that I find myself really watching, not to take away from anything else, right? I just enjoy the lifestyle elements in there, right? Mm-hmm. Like, it's like you see, Avalanche in the backyard, barbecuing. Yeah. You just want to hang out with Rocky and those guys, right? Like, it's that intersection of life and the sport. Like, I'll give you one story here. Sorry. I happen to know Stacy Peralta from Dogtown Z Boys, like amazing filmmaker, director. The dude's brilliant. I met him through storyboards. I was storyboarding his commercials back in the day. And he would like do these weird, like fat tire beer ads that all centered around like a mountain bike unicyclist. Right. And like, so he is intrigued by these like outside fringe sports. And I said, hey, Stacy, I want to come up. I want to sit down. I want to have coffee with you, dude. And I want to show you something. I want to show you something that I'm passionate about. I brought my laptop and I had paintball on there. Right. And I had the 2015. I had some of the like the HK videos on there. I had the 2015 game from you guys. And because I think those are some of the more cutting edge material at the time. Mm-hmm. And I sat down there and we're having coffee. Right. And we're sitting, and I show him the thing. And dude, he's watching those HK videos and he's like, riveted, right, for about 2 minutes, and then he leans back and he looks at me and he goes, this really got me, it really hooked me, I was captivated, I wanted to watch more. And he's like, and then after 2 minutes I thought to myself, I can't see myself doing this. These guys look like super soldiers. It's interesting, right? Like, he's like, we did this, he goes, and he told me, he goes, we made this same mistake in skateboarding. He's like, we tried to force the sport into vert because that's what we thought was the consumable perspective. And he's like, and street skateboarding saved it.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Right? Like, that's not to say Go Sports is wrong. It's not. It's just to say, like, let's have different sects, right? Let's embrace every part of paintball. And you guys know that, you guys are doing that, but that's an interesting perspective, right? He's like, if you showed a guy like in a hoodie out here playing, he's like, I can relate to that guy, you know? But let's look at what that game is, right? It's ultra athletic, trending younger players who are doing Superman dives into bunkers, you know? And it's like, okay, well, if you want the sport to grow, what demographic are you going to grow it in? Do we need an over 40 league? I don't know. Maybe. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you're right. You got to have, dough to play some paintball. So
I remember those guys back, the 40-year-olds were like the only ones that could like have the RV that we could ride to the field with, that could all the bills. I remember taking a trip to Portland. We were, you know, seven broke asses all piled into one room. I remember we were letting off fireworks in the hotel room. Don't do that. Bad idea. The manager comes in. He goes, what the hell are you guys doing? How the hell are you guys paying for this room? We're like, cash. Get out of here. He's kicking us right out. He's like, you're done. You're out of this hotel. We're like, no. We'll give him a card. I think one of the guys had to peel off and give him his mom's credit card to put on the room so he wouldn't kick us out. Oh, you know, but it's like that older demo is like what keeps the sport anchored. It has the biggest disposable income. And like the point of entry into paintball, it's tremendous, right? To play at a tournament level, it's thousands of dollars. That's not even, that's just your equipment, dude. Like, think about skateboarding. It's $200. You get a complete, top level complete and a pair of shoes. You have the best equipment possible. So I'm like, is there like a stock class tournament series where you get an E-Mech, a speed loader, and $100 high pressure system? And like, let's play for 10 grand.
There we go. Yeah.
And like, okay, great. Like, look, that's not to say there shouldn't be open. There should be open, but like, maybe there's a stock class. Maybe there's sprint, Indy Sprint, like whatever we need to do.
Yeah. I love that. Whatever we need to do. Yeah, just as much of it as possible. Yeah.
Yeah. I like the idea of having as many different formats as possible. You know, you look at things like snowboarding or motocross, skateboarding. There's all sorts of different ways to do it, to ride a surfboard, to ride a skateboard, a snowboard, a motorcycle. So certainly with a paintball gun, there's so many different ways that you can play with a paintball gun. Absolutely. The scenario side of the game is something that anyone can relate to. Everyone grew up with soldiers and pretending military. You know, I think majority of at least. And, you know, nowadays, like Tyler always talks about, majority of kids grow up playing Call of Duty, you know, and these kind of war games. But if you see some, you know, players in camouflage simulating, okay, you have like a general and this and that, that's appetizing to the general public. And then you have the extreme side as well, which is what we do. I agree, dude. I think, and you know, to be honest, Go Sports has done a fantastic job, NXL as well, of moving into that space and you know, again, broadcasting ICC. I mean, thank the Lord for Tim Montresor, what Tim built for everybody, for the paintball community. What he has left us with is going to be everlasting and could potentially be a you know, when we look back in 20 years, could have been the pivotal point that changed our game, because he brought 10 man back. He brought the woods back. He brought the love for that competition and the need or the willingness to showcase that part of the game as well. And I think we're on the right direction with that, because again, it's palatable for the masses. It's palatable for people that aren't just the extreme paintball lovers that just, you know, understand X ball and the sportiness of it.
Yeah.
So it's, yeah. You know, something that, like, I know this is, I'm not going to take credit for this. This is Maddie Marshall's idea. You know, we've had quite a few lunches and talked endless hours about paintball, but this would be a really cool concept. You take like me and Tyler, two of us, and you grab 50 civilians, 50, you know, and you set up on this like scenario where me and Tyler have to protect this fort against 50 people. And honestly, we would probably mow them down. It's like your dad in the back of your backyard with his back against the river, you know, like it would be just like that. And people that would watch that don't know anything about paintball, be like, wait, what is this, John Wick? Who are these guys? What, this is the Matrix. What's going on here? You know?
And I've heard you talk about this idea a couple times now, and the only thing I don't like is that you haven't done it yet.
You're right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, you guys have the juice.
You're right.
Let's go.
We need to do that.
Strap the GoPro on. Yeah. I'll fly the drone. We can let them out like waves at the beaches of Normandy coming at you guys.
Yeah. Oh,
like, man. This is relatively simple. You get HK out there with their media arm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're not wrong. Done. You got it.
You're not wrong. The toughest part,
it's in the works.
It's
in the works.
Yeah. I put it on my list. Now that I actually physically wrote this down.
You wrote it down. Yeah. Physically
written down. So
see, when you write something down, it actually enters into the physical fabric of the universe. It actually becomes like a part of physical. Yeah. It's a thing now.
I'm not even joking. Marcelo, you could, if you guys don't have practice next weekend, you can get this going by next weekend, dude. Yeah. Oh yeah. Hey,
yeah.
We need walk-ons or whoever, relatively newer players, to come out and play with Tyler and Marcel. Oh yeah. Mm-hmm. No one's showing up for that.
Yeah.
No. Hold on a second. Hold on. We can't. That's how you get ringers. That's how you get a few ringers. Okay. We're gonna be playing against 50 like Division IV kids that come showing up as camouflage. We got to go pull them off the street. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Okay. All right. But I also like you guys threw that idea out there of like playing other professional athletes as well.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah? Like do that.
I think that's yes.
Another great idea, right? It's like, absolutely. That's just to show how much effort and how much skill you guys actually possess in this game that people might look at first glance and be like, eh, I don't get it, you know? Mm-hmm. But you show them what the discipline it takes to be as good as you are. Now they get it.
Yeah, you have to show them. You have to do the work and not, like you said, not rely on anybody. This isn't going to happen through, you know, like that. It's going to be us going out and attacking it.
No truer words, Tyler. Like, that's it, brother. No one's coming to save you. You got to save yourself. And that's one thing Ian and I learned early on, man. No one's coming to save you. If you want to do this, I'm telling you, Ian and I, like, our mantra is nothing is more attractive than when you don't need someone. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't need you guys. Imagine if you're like already getting your own endorsements and everyone, they start coming out of the woodwork. Oh, I don't need that job. Oh, guess what? You got jobs coming all over the place.
Totally.
Mm-hmm. It's like and not only, you know, in dating,
of course,
but in the business world, man.
Yeah.
No, you're right, man. Wow, what a treat. I just have one more question here. It's from Richard. Shout out to Richard, Texas Hammer. He's wondering, do you think that the Best Kids in Texas film made an impact and we will hopefully see more movies like that that'll be coming out? How funny is that, that we already know of one that's coming? But that was his question there.
I think Dan did a great job on that movie. I really enjoyed it.
Me too.
I think it made an impact. Absolutely. I watched it and was affected, and I can't speak for the reach. I don't have the metrics on it, you know, but I know a lot, like the community supported it. Now, how much crossover did it get? I don't know. Yeah. But I feel like the more stuff like that, the better. And I think you just have to lead with what you're passionate about. And you can't, it's interesting, right? In Hollywood, there's this thing they do where they try to chase the trends. Well, if you're chasing the trend, guess what? The wave's already crested. There's a new set coming in. And so you just have to go with what you're passionate about and hope that coalesces with what is in the zeitgeist. That's it. Lead with nothing else. Just go, you know what? I'm really passionate about this. Let's go do it. I don't necessarily think the world was clamoring for a Santa Claus movie where you had a 12-year-old boy hire a hitman. I don't think that was, they knew they wanted that until it was presented to them, right?
That's it, man. That's it. Lead with that passion, dude. What a tremendous honor it has been chatting with you. We're going to have you back and break the movie that you're going to drop on the world at some point. And man, thank you so much for the insight and for your time and everything that you do in paintball and the ideas and the pure passion and creativity that you bring to the landscape in Hollywood and in the paintball world. We're just so honored and blessed to have you with us, man. Thank you.
Well, thanks for having me, guys. Honestly, I'm a big fan of your work. Love the podcast. And I'm watching those Dynasty games with bated breath, hoping for those W's.
Yep, we're going to bring them, man. We're going to bring them.
Absolutely. Yes, Esham, sir. Thanks, brother.
Well, you stay safe. And, and we will we'll have this live in no time. We'll be live.
Perfect.
That was an amazing episode. My goodness, I could have sat there and talked to Esham for hours on end. I'm sure we will have him back on the show. Love his ideas. Love everything that he is proposing for us to do within the sport of paintball. I think you said it very well. Nobody's coming to save us. We have to do our best. We have to do our part. So anyone out there, all the listeners, PTG fam, let's show out. Let's share all of this stuff. Share the podcast. Share Go Sports. Share any paintball footage that's on YouTube. Let's do what we can to continue to push our sport in front of the masses. You're already seeing, Instagram pages like SportsCenter posting paintball clips. So let's continue to show out for that stuff. And eventually this sport could be, bigger than it is now very, very soon. You know, it's not that far off. We have an amazing game. So I think we're on the brink. I think we're very close. And we just need to continue pushing. If you guys want, you can head over to ptgpaintball.com, become a supporter of the show. We would greatly appreciate it. We have an amazing Discord, which is a private group chat for all of our PTG supporters, our PTG teammates,
and the Discord is lit. It is really cool. It is an amazing community that we are building in there. No matter what level of Patreon you decide to sign up for, you get access to the Discord. So, you know, the only difference is some other things that we will be including, which is all over there on the Patreon. Again, you can head over to ptgpaintball.com, click the Patreon link, and see if there is a tier that is for you. But any tier will get you access to the super awesome exclusive private group chat that is going off literally right now. I see it in the bottom corner of my computer screen. It is going off with notifications, and I love the community that is being built in there. Our website is brought to you by Rusty Glaze at Concept Pursuit. You guys already know if you need a website, Rusty is your guy. He does a fantastic job. It's very affordable and just the highest class of web design. All right, everybody, until next time, we'll see you soon.